Now, what should I do with you?
You cannot just arrest him. You must find a different way. You may have to kill him. Does this discourage you?
Huh?
Just tell me where he is.
I'm here, Mr. Bond of the British Secret Service. But I'll tell you, it is Christatos you want, not me. He told you about himself. He's the one with the powerful connections. Locke works for him, not for me. I smuggle, yes, I smuggle gold, diamond, cigarettes, pistachio nuts, but no heroin. Sit down. That I leave to him when he is not too busy working for Russia against my country and yours.
My country awarded him the King's Medal.
Yes, I know. But other people died for it. All through the fighting in Crete, he was a double agent. King's Medal. I would laugh if my heart was not so heavy about my poor Liesl.
What does Christatus gain by setting you up?
Well, I know too much about him. He wants me out of the way. By using a British agent to do his dirty work for him, your government might give him another medal.
Why should I believe you?
Well, I'll prove it to you tonight. We'll go together to his warehouse in Albania. Okay?
If I don't report in by tomorrow morning, not only will my people, but the entire Greek police be down on you like a load of bricks.
Don't worry. By tomorrow, we'll be good friends. Let us drink to that.
I'll wait till tomorrow.
You may need this. I'm a good judge of men. Mr. Bond, you have what the Greeks call thrasos, guts.
So have you, Mr. Colombo.
Cheers.
Yasu.
Who are you?
Bond. James Bond.
I think you're a sexist, misogynist dinosaur. A relic of the Cold War.
Shaken, but not stirred.
007 reporting for duty.
These are the 00 files.
Welcome to the 00 Files. This is going to be our sixth movie review, and today we'll be taking a look into Roger Moore's fifth Bond movie, For Your Eyes Only. My name is Tyler, and I'm your host for today. But of course, I'm not going to review this movie all by myself. I will get a lot of help from my fellow Bond aficionados who are here with me. Let's give them a chance to introduce themselves and answer today's question: what classic Bond movie would you like to see in the cinema? First off, he entered a room skiing over the dinner table while being chased by a big, blonde German guy on a motorcycle. It's Don!
Hey, that's
Don,
me!
How are you?
Let me first put my skis in the corner. I'm fine, thank you, thank you. Great introduction. What classic film would I like to see in the cinema? It has to be my first Bond film, You Only Live Twice. Because imagine seeing that huge volcano set.
Oh, I was thinking about Aki, but...
You are, yeah. I'm sure you was. But yeah, imagine the volcano with the ninjas coming down, or little Nelly on the big screen. Oh, I'd love that.
Good choice, good choice. Our second member of the team found some time in his busy schedule of beating up hockey players and riding his Zamboni to join us today. It's Anthony!
Yes,
hello, Anthony!
Yes. I'm going to go for one of my top three all-time favorite Bonds, and I've decided to choose the one that I think will be the most stunning to see on the big screen, Majesties, of course. Seeing Piz Gloria and those beautiful slopes, Bond skiing down, the Barry sound in the background. Wow, I'd like to see that in the theater.
Yeah, I concur, yeah.
Good choice, good choice. And finally, the youngest agent in our team, his uncle Harry thinks he's still a virgin, but we know better.
Thank you, thank you.
It's Martin! Martin, how are you today?
Well, I was good until that one. Thank you for that. I'll remember that. Moving on, what film I... Well, I've been giving it some thought, and I think I'm going to go for From Russia with Love. To go for a nice, classic, a bit of a dark 60s vibe in cinema. That would be very good.
Yes, well,
very good.
Good choices all around. Good choices all around.
Ice cream.
Like I said, my name is Tyler. I'll be your host for today. And I think the Bond movie that I would like to see most in cinema is... I think Moonraker.
Interesting.
Not because it's one of my favorite movies, but I think seeing it on the big screen will do the film more justice than on TV.
Oh, and the wonderful soundtrack with
And the location.
I concur. I think it will be even better on the big screen.
As well. Yeah. Today we will be reviewing 1981's For Your Eyes Only. Let's have a quick plot summary before we start. After his adventures in space, Bond returns back to Earth, trying to find the ATAC, an advanced targeting attack communicator that was lost when a British spy ship sank in the Ionian Sea. In the end, Bond saves the day by destroying the ATAC before the Russians can get their hands on it. In between, shit happens. Here we go. So we start with the gun barrel opening.
That's a pretty good summary, actually.
I thought so as well. Yeah. I thought, let's get it over with and let's start with our movie review.
The film
review.
Opens, stuff happens.
The film ends.
Yeah, exactly.
Shit happens quite a lot in Bond films, actually.
Yeah. Quite a shitty world he lives in. Anyway, we start with the gun barrel, as always, in these classic Bond movies. And it's a very distinct sounding gun barrel opening.
Very groovy.
Pretty groovy, exactly. Anything to add to that?
Well, it's of course the soundtrack from Bill Conti. Let's get right to it. I know that there are a lot of people who dislike the score. I'm not one of them. I think the score is brilliant.
Yeah,
it's so
fantastic.
Groovy from start to finish.
Yeah, it is. It's a very funky opening to the James Bond film, I think. He did Rocky, right?
He did Rocky. Yeah,
that was like a few years before this.
Yeah, that was his claim to fame.
And then John Barry wasn't available, probably due to tax reasons or something
like
that.
Yeah, I've heard about that.
But it's pretty much a classic gun barrel, and you get the same Roger like you do in Spy and Moonraker. It's in color. So that's sometimes it's in black and white, I think. But then this music, it's wonderful. Yeah. It's fresh. It's
energetic.
Yeah, it has spunk.
Yeah.
Really sets the tone for the rest of the soundtrack, really.
I don't think it's dated. I read somewhere that people find the soundtrack dated, but I don't agree with that.
Well, I think it's dated in a very good way. Now, the same way that, just pick any Bee Gees song is dated in a good way, if you ask me.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
Well, I've been living with this soundtrack in my ears for the past 2 weeks, so it kind of clouds my judgment, maybe, but yeah.
You must be feeling groovy then.
Yeah, definitely, yeah.
It's ideal to listen to it in a car.
Or when at night, or when you're cycling to work.
On skis, So we open the movie with Bond visiting Tracy's grave. This is only the second time that Tracy is referenced after You Only Live Twice, or after On Her Majesty's Secret Service, I'm sorry. The first time, of course, was in The Spy Who Loved Me, and I think it's a nice little reference, originally written, because they were very much in doubt whether Roger Moore would return as Bond. So the writers put this in to show the audience that this is still the same James Bond that we all know and love. What do you guys think? Do you like this little nod to Tracy, or not so much?
Yeah, I'm all for little bits of continuity and stringing everything together, so
yeah,
fine with me.
I did wonder, however, that she was killed, of course, in Portugal, and then she was transported back to the UK to be buried there.
Apparently, yeah.
Her father would agree with that, because he was a wanted criminal, so he would not be able to visit the grave of her daughter. I know, I'm going way beyond
any logic. Was he a
wanted
criminal, or just one of those keeping his own hands clean while being the boss of a giant crime syndicate?
I agree, but I don't think he would go traveling all around Europe.
Maybe not.
But she was now Mrs. Bond, so maybe, he has no say in the thing.
I know, it doesn't make sense, but yeah. I watched the film a few days ago, and that's what popped into my mind.
It's a shame he never came back, Draco.
No, I mean, that would have been cool.
It's a character that could easily have come back. But
he comes back in...
In a book by Benson.
Yeah, I'm thinking about...
Was it Never Dream of Dying?
Exactly, yeah.
Was that it?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. That's a long time ago. But yeah, it's a nice little scene. It's a lovely little graveyard. It's right next to Stoke Poges, the golf club. Goldfinger's golf club, yeah.
Right. So Bond is picked up by a UNIVAC helicopter that's remotely controlled by a bald man in a wheelchair who is holding a cat, who is very much not Blofeld. And we get some very nice stunt work by Martin Grace, I believe. Roger Moore's double, climbing outside of the helicopter, gaining control of the helicopter, flying it through the gasworks near London. I think this is a great pre-title sequence.
What do you make of the priest sign when he's lifting off?
Yeah. If God wanted man to fly.
Yeah, is it like an omen? Is he in on the Blofeld plot?
Yeah, he's in on it.
Is it just something he does because he's afraid of flying?
I think so.
It's think quite so. Distressing when you see the priest.
It's more like the very serious face he makes. I always thought like, is he or is he not in? I don't know. I think they left it up to the audience, but.
Or is this a standard way to say farewell to anyone?
Maybe, yeah, Bond doesn't seem to understand what he's doing. He's giving him a look like, what's going on?
Say, like, that little shot of Bond's reaction is...
Yeah. Maybe he's just mad that someone lands a helicopter on his graveyard. I don't know.
But he also wears a ring with an octopus on it, huh? You see it?
No, I haven't noticed that.
It's always a giveaway.
You have it on 4K now, the
yeah,
film.
You can see anything.
You can see everything.
It's
yeah.
brilliant.
How does this rank in your pre-title sequence, top 50?
I'm not a huge fan of it. It's a bit of a strange scene, I think. The stunt work is... I like that, but it's... You know, Blofeld is just making silly remarks, and then Bond picks him up and drops him down the chimney. Doesn't do it for me. I would have preferred if they would have started the film with the scene in which the parents of Melina are killed. And then you see the look in her eyes. That would have been a strong opening.
They filmed that to be the pre-title sequence, the killing of her parents, yeah.
Yeah.
I like it. I really like this because it's not related to the film yet. You say that you like the stunt work. I think the stunt work is amazing. Mm. If you see what they're doing, you would never... in 1,000 years get me to get out of a helicopter when it's in flight and crawl along the edge of it and try to take over the pilot's chair. I think it's very well done. And they also use, what do you call that? Like a miniature set that's in front of the camera?
Yeah, foreground miniature.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Foreground miniature, yeah. That's it. Yeah, that's you can't see it.
No, you can't.
I mean, I know where it is, but I still can't
like
see it.
It's just like an octopus.
Or the lift rails, they do it as well with the bridge.
With the bridge.
It's amazing.
Yeah. I love that instead of all the CGI. And I know that it's not Blofeld, but we all know it is Blofeld. It's also a big fuck you to Kevin McClory at the same time because he wanted to come up with his remake. Yeah. It's like, okay, go ahead. We don't need
that. That reason alone makes it a very good pre-title.
But I found it strange that they use Majesty's Blofeld and not Charles Gray's Blofeld.
Because they also use, of course, the grave of Tracy.
So. Yeah. Yeah, so it kind of makes sense.
Then it makes sense.
Now, do you know who voices Blofeld here?
Yeah, he died 2 years ago, something
like
that.
He's in Star Wars as well, right? He's the Lobot.
Is he?
Yeah, I believe so. He's in Star Wars as well.
I haven't looked that up, but I looked up his name because I know he also voiced other famous characters in the Bond franchise, like Largo and Taika Tanaka. Mm. And he even voiced part of Strangways, apparently, according to IMDb, but I'm not sure about that. Also, he's a casino baccarat official in Majesty's, and he plays the part of an Italian minister in Never Say Never Again.
Wow.
So it's like a very big James Bond veteran.
Wow.
Like the Maud Adams of bit parts.
He's in more Bond films than Brosnan.
Exactly.
Wow.
Exactly. Yeah. He was called Robert Rietti. Want, but he has a very distinctive voice. I love it.
Yeah, especially his laugh.
Goodbye, Mr. Bond. I trust you had a pleasant fright.
Martin, anything to add to that?
No, not really. Well, just like the music again. I think the moment Bond pulls the plug on the camera and then all hell breaks loose.
That's
brilliant. It just goes on. It just goes
every single time.
To the wall. It's great. That's just what makes the scene for me.
It's very funny how Blofeld then punches the dashboard. It looks so silly. It's like, it's not working.
Yeah, but that's a Bond thing to do as well. Like every time he's in a vehicle and he's out of fuel, and then he just taps the gauges, and that's just a thing people always do. And whenever something electronic stops, just hit it and it'll work again.
The only thing I don't like, though, is that Blofeld turns into a dummy as soon as he's being thrown into the chimney.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But,
okay. Yeah, we'll get to dummies in about 2 hours when Kriegler is being thrown off the roof. But anyways...
But what is the worst dummy of all Bond films?
The one in A View to a Kill.
No.
Hands down.
No, I think the one
from
in...
From the Zeppelin?
What? Yeah.
I think the one in Tomorrow Never Dies. The guys in the helicopter.
Yeah,
they're
rubbish.
They're the worst dummy. Why did they cast
like
those dummies?
They're cardboard cutouts.
Don't spoil our dummy ranking episode, yet, please. Okay. So, okay, let's go on to the title song, sung by Sheena Easton. It's very 80s. But again, in a good way, I think. Any opinions on this hit song?
It doesn't do much for me. It's a bit too slow and yeah, I don't
really?
Know. It's a bit forgettable. Really? I used to like it very much, but now I usually skip it when it's like in the playlist or something like that. I don't know.
I prefer the instrumental version.
Yeah.
You hear in the film.
The one that comes on later.
I know my mother loved it. She played it quite a lot when I was a young kid.
I like the lyrics. I like the ballad. It's nice. It's calm. If you feel like relaxing, music you can fall asleep to instead of Few to a Kill, for instance.
Yeah, but if you look at ballads, I'd rather have Nobody Does It Better or Octopussy or one of the other ones, or Lies to Kill.
I like this one.
Yeah.
It's a lot on the Dutch radio, right? If you
this one?
Yeah, this one or A Few to a Kill. So it's one of the classics. You never hear The Man with the Golden Gun, for instance.
Right, thank God. No. but I love this little anecdote because it's the first time that we see the artist who sings the title song.
Yeah. It's the only time, even.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. In the title sequence. And that's because Marius Binder really wanted to use her in it.
Mm-hmm.
He wanted that very, very close up of her lips after the first verse or the first chorus. But Sheena Easton couldn't keep her head still enough. Binder got some sort of contraption with a clamp to keep her head in place so that he could get that close-up shot of her.
He really has a way with the ladies,
yeah,
doesn't he?
He does, he does. And according to Sheena Easton, it looked really sexy, but it hurt like hell. And I actually thought it was something that I wanted to mention. So we're at the spice ship.
The visuals. The visuals of the title song.
Please.
Anything to remark there? These are, I think, typical 80 Maurice Binder stuff. Very watery, floating ladies. Got a lot of naked women, which is always nice, I think.
Yeah, because that's like the staple Binder thing, isn't it? The ladies and the
maybe.
Women.
Yeah, but it's not really unique.
No, it's not unique. No, it's a bit generic.
It is
because it has the artist in there.
Yeah, okay.
It's almost like an MTV music video before MTV music videos existed.
Is it the music video?
This is the first one, isn't it?
Yeah, is it the music video to this song, the title sequence without the titles?
I think it is, yeah.
Yeah, I believe so.
Could be. Mm. And I noticed that Topol doesn't have a last name,
which is kind of
silly, isn't it?
It's
like an artist name?
He actually doesn't have a first name.
Oh, is it just his last
name?
His
name is Chaim.
Ah, there you go. And
which is Michael... not a trivia question, by the way.
Okay. And Michael Wilson is now already executive producer. Yep. He's really climbing up the ranks there. Yep. Yeah. Yep. Well done, Michael.
And also co-writer of the script.
Mm.
Can we go to the St. George's?
Mm.
We are.
That was my Frederick Gray impression. Did you know this?
Yeah.
Freddie Gray being a bee. Okay, so at that spy ship, people do spy things, but unfortunately a sea mine is dragged in by the fishing nets, the ship explodes, and the crew fail to destroy the ATAC system. Some pretty gruesome deaths in this scene.
Oh, man.
Really? Yeah. Yeah. Not Bondian at all. You see people struggling, trying to survive, being electrocuted.
Yeah, they really were going a different course with this film after Moonraker, and this is one of the scenes that shows it, I think. It's not, but I also, for instance, the death of Liesel is also pretty brutal. And there are a few scenes in the film that are quite brutal, and this is definitely one of them.
Oh. Yeah, it's a bit more realistic, a bit more raw. There's a whole new team, right, that makes this film instead of Moonraker. You got a bunch of new people coming in.
And rightfully so, I think. A new decade, new direction.
Yeah, but also lots of young people, young crew.
Yeah, you get John Glenn,
cheap,
of course.
Probably, because they had a lot less budget to work with for this film, but yeah.
Okay, so they fail to destroy the ATAC system. And for some reason, everybody knows that they fail to destroy that because, well, first of all, we see two very gray-haired men enter the office of the Minister of Defense, who asks, how deep is the water there? And the response is, not deep enough. And immediately we go over to Moscow, where we see General Gogol. Hooray, he's back, flirting with this secretary as always.
Oh, yes.
And we learn that Gogol has sent his usual men in Greece to try to find out if they can obtain the ATAC.
Who is his usual guy in Greece?
Christatos.
Is it?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay.
Yeah, wouldn't have been like, I've been thinking about this, wouldn't this have been like a great little cameo for Anya though?
Well, actually, this is something I noticed this time. This film is like part of several trilogies, and this is the Rubelvich trilogy.
His secretary
is called Rubelvich, and she's played by Eva Rober-Steyer. I had to look that up. And she plays the same part in The Spy Who Loved Me and Octopussy. Same actress.
She's not a Moonraker, the brief scene we see Gogol?
No.
Okay.
And then there's a character called Rubavitch, who is the lover of Pushkin in The Living Daylights. Different character, different actress, almost same name. Doesn't make any sense. But anyway, what I wanted to say is For Your Eyes Only is part of the Rubelvich trilogy.
It's also the same set we see here, where we see Gogol.
Spy Who Loved Me. Probably. Looks the same.
Yeah.
Empty chair, empty room, chair in the background.
Chair in the background.
Yeah, that's
That is typical Ken Adamant, though. Chair in the background.
Yeah, I was told it was just a matte painting. But
could be.
Oh, okay.
But I really like these two very short scenes. We immediately know what's going on and what will be the main plot of this movie. I think it's brilliantly done, actually. Just 2 minutes.
Exposition without it being obvious exposition.
Exactly. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And 12 minutes in, we see Melina Havelock for the first time, our Bond girl of this movie. She's on board a seaplane, flown by a very shifty-looking character. he's not evil at all.
Why did you enter the plane with a guy like that?
Yeah,
you even see the gun on the plane already.
Yeah, just asking for trouble.
And Melina is going out to visit her parents and Max the parrot. Let's not forget Max. On their research ship, the shifty pilot guns down Melina's parents, accompanied by some great acting by Max the parrot. Like you said, Anthony, this should have been the pre-title sequence before they came up with the entire Blofeld scheme.
Yep.
Not Blofeld scheme, I'm sorry.
Strong scene.
Very strong scene. You immediately know what Melina's backstory is, what her motivation is for this movie, and again, pretty gruesome death of her parents, and the close-up of her eyes is very nicely done.
Yeah, you also, I noticed when I saw the film a few days ago, when Melina kneels at the side of her mother, you see her father laying in the background, totally covered with blood.
You don't see blood that often in Bond films, no?
Exactly.
And what about the breaking of the fourth wall here, then, when she looks into the camera?
Strong.
Yeah, I was gonna say it's not really a fourth wall break. Well, let me say, like, if I think of a fourth wall break, I actually think of people actually interacting with the audience. This is
talking
just her.
To you.
Yeah.
How about that?
Exactly.
But it is.
Do
a
you
strong
mind it?
No, I don't mind it, but no, but it is different. It's something that you haven't seen in a long time. It would have been nice, maybe, if this was the ending of the pre-title sequence, now that you mention it.
But it would have been another pre-title sequence without James Bond in it.
That's true.
Yeah, and I don't know if you guys heard anything about like the very first drafts of this movie, but apparently, well, for those who have...
006's girlfriend?
Yeah, like, well, of course, there would have been a whole M subplot, like in the original short story.
Yeah.
But from what I've gathered, and this is all the internet, so I have no idea how reputable it is, but apparently it should have been like a Havelock and 006 being meeting together and them getting shot. So there's like another motivation for M to send Bond in.
Hmm. Okay.
So I don't mind, though.
I reread the short story as well, and it's rather different there. It's set in Jamaica.
Yeah, I really love the short story, though. It's one of the best ones I've read so far of the Flemings.
Like, it's basically a three-parter. Yeah. First, you have the Jamaica scene where, was it Gonzalez? I think it's Gonzalez with the two gunmen threatens the Havelocks, but the daughter's not there. And it's a very tense scene. They offer him money to get out of the house, but they don't want to leave, and then they're gunned down.
Can I stop you there, because I have some trivia questions for that?
Don't please continue.
What they did for this film is they used so much of the short stories, this one and Risiko, but then they changed critical elements as well. For instance, here that Melina is actually part of the assassination. Yeah. Maybe she was supposed to be assassinated herself, even. We don't know that.
No.
So it's tries to stay close to the original story, but then again, it also updates it for the film. I think they did a very good job combining those two stories into one narrative.
Yeah. I agree.
Really like that. Yeah. Yeah.
Can I just say that Melina is probably the most beautiful Bond girl there is?
She is very lovely. Yeah, I agree.
What about Aki?
No, I don't think Aki is the most beautiful Bond girl there is. Ah. She's just the greatest Bond girl there is.
Ah, okay.
Those are two different things.
Coral Bouquet is very, very charming.
I think Don and I don't agree. No, I think
she's very pretty.
But she sometimes looks a bit lazy out of her eyes.
I don't know. She just looks like
she's very pretty. She's
She became the
beautiful
face
lady.
Of Chanel, I believe.
I love her hair. Okay. She has beautiful long hair. Yeah.
We'll get to her acting, I think.
I wouldn't say no if she would ring the bell.
But I found strange is that they dubbed her.
Why did
they dub her? And she dubbed herself, right? In the,
no,
the French one.
Oh, you spoiled another trivia question. Martin,
I'll
you get
shut
that
up
part. This is amazing. I will have to think of another trivia question if one of you happens to...
I'll think of something, the short story.
The easy one there. all right, but indeed, she did dub herself in the French version.
Now I know why I asked the trivia questions at the beginning of the podcast last time.
You did them during the podcast.
Yeah, but also well before we got to the part discussing the possible trivia subjects. Yeah. Okay. Well, I'll shut up.
Well, we're only 15 minutes into the movie, so it's not like we had much to spoil yet. But so after that great close-up on Melina's eyes, we see Moneypenny, who is getting on in age, but who's putting on some makeup when we see an old Bond item fly across the room. Although we never see him wear it in this movie, Bond's trilby makes a return after 12 years, I believe.
Yeah, for classic Bond.
Yeah, I like that little nod to the classic Bond. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And it's also something that's not weird. Like, I can totally see Roger Moore walking around London wearing a trilby.
Yeah. But we don't ever see it, right? And none of the seven Bond films.
I think Honor Majesty's Secret Service.
But we don't see Roger Moore wearing a hat. No.
Do you think Moneypenny's very flirty in the scene? He's touching Jane. And,
Not really.
No.
I do like that he almost walks into M's office with the flower in it.
Exactly.
As M's away.
What else would he have done with it? Give it to M?
Yeah, I don't know.
Now that would be cool.
Freddie Gray is there, so.
Yeah.
Freddie.
And Moneypenny, of course, tells Bond that M is on leave because actor Bernard Lee died in 1981. In January, and the producers decided not to recast the role of M for this movie, instead dividing his lines between the chief of staff and Q. What do you guys think? Was this a good idea? Do you miss M? Should they have recast him?
I like can really respect the decision to not recast M so suddenly, but it is really a great loss for the character because it's such a pivotal element of the original story. So that's a bit of a wasted. Well, it's just like a sad occasion that Bernard couldn't make it anymore.
Yeah, I'd like to think that M is back on his mission to Tokyo and join whatever he did there. But yeah, he's very, very, very much missed in this film, I think.
I think not just the M character, but Bernard Lee is M. I think we can all agree. Yeah.
However,
I think it's good they didn't recast him yet.
No, but thanks to M being on leave, we do get your favorite character of all time, Don.
I hate
the film.
That guy.
I know.
The Chief of Staff.
Love Bill Tanner in the books. I love him, especially when he's playing golf with Bond or joking about the old man or whatever. But not this jerk. Come on, he's a complete twat.
I was going to say the quintessential bureaucrat. He's everything
he does
don't
everything
like about
wrong.
Public
service. Yeah, but also his voice. So why don't you use the identigraph? Ah, it's terrible.
He reminds me of your description of Vesper with the corners of his mouth hanging on his knees all the time.
Get cracking, 007. Yeah.
No, I don't like this Tanner.
Oh, well. So your favorite character, the Chief of Staff, asks Bond what he knows of the ATAC system. And Bond, of course, knows everything there is to know about the thing. So we, as an audience, do too.
Do you know what it does, the ATAC?
Yeah, something with missiles and...
Our own submarines can be ordered to attack our own cities.
Do you want to know? I had to write this
you
down.
You wrote it down, probably. Yeah.
It uses an ultra-low frequency coded transmitter to order submarines to launch ballistic missiles.
There we go.
Whatever that might mean. I don't know.
I remember when I saw the ATAC in the exposition a few years ago. The
actual typewriter thing?
Yeah, that they used in the film.
But it was smashed to pieces.
No, they had it in the...
They had
the name of the exposition that was...
Designing 007?
Designing 007, it was there. You probably saw it. It looked pretty crappy, I thought.
Yeah.
But, okay.
That's probably the one they threw off the cliff and then put back the enemy.
Yeah, maybe.
Such a shame that they didn't find a new home for that exposition, because it was really a nice place to go to when it was in Rotterdam.
Yeah, so probably visited
it went to Dubai afterwards, I think. And then it just ceased to exist, right?
Yeah. Well, I think it went to... Didn't it go to like Washington or New York or something like that?
It had a few stops afterwards. Yeah. Some of us in Sydney,
Australia,
I believe, as well. But nowadays it's just somewhere in storage. You can still rent it.
Okay.
So if you have an exposition room, you can rent the stuff you need and they will come and build it up for you. But
probably quite cheap.
Yeah, probably not. But
I still have some room here. So I live in Coruscant. So.
So Bond is sent to Gonzalez's villa near Madrid, right?
Yep.
Right.
Yep. We hear a great sound from
Operation
Bill Conti again.
Yeah. We see him in a white lotus.
Yay.
Bond sneaks into Gonzalez's villa, accompanied by the most 80s sounding song you will ever hear.
Oh my God.
And the guy dancing on the lawn.
Yeah.
Have you listened to the lyrics of this song?
It's like we interrupt this Bond film for a Playboy Mansion like cutaway. It's just...
Doesn't make any sense. You're singing. Can you feel it inside you? Try to keep it up. And ease it in. This is like the most suggestive song ever.
So, what's this about? I don't know.
It's about being groovy.
And about diamonds, of course. Yes.
Oh my God. This is it's a horrible song.
I think it's such a cool scene, this. I love the guy dancing there. The girls walking around. And then
it really like builds the character of Gonzalez being this sleazy guy. Yeah.
Yeah. Cool.
The guard that starts kissing the girl. Was that Bob Simmons?
I thought
he had a cameo.
No,
I don't know.
I find it so funny that the girl walks
for
out. Yeah, maybe. I read it somewhere.
I was
going to
say, he's just standing there with like the
he's
big ass gun.
Just standing there, and then
a girl
walks up and immediately start making out. So funny.
Yeah. He probably heard the song as well.
Well, this is what we have to do, so let's do it.
Sexy Jew.
Well, anyway, everybody's having a great time at the villa, and we see a slightly overdressed gentleman paying Gonzalez, apparently for the murder of the Havelocks. And I would like to direct your attention to Gonzalez's shorts, which are the shortest shorts that I've ever seen. Those things are criminally short.
That man deserves an arrow in his back.
Yeah, and we'll get to that, because Bond is captured, and Gonzalez immediately notices that he is MI6, because he has a Walter PPK, which is nowadays standard issue for British Secret Service, license to kill
or be killed.
Take him away.
Great.
But when Bond gets caught, though, he's being held by this guy, and another guy immediately grabs inside
inside his jacket and takes out the gun from his holster, clearly showing that he's an actor instructed to take the gun away from the holster, because there's no way you can know that Bond would have a gun there. No, just, I found it funny that he knew exactly where to get it.
Yeah.
That's it.
Yeah, all right.
Or could it have been like just like something I just came up with right now? Could it be something to do with the whole 006 story? Like they already knew their 00 agents, and so they're like, well, there's probably another agent.
Ooh.
Could be.
Wow. You mean with all the leftover script rewrites and stuff
yeah,
like that?
A little leftover bit. I don't know.
He does anyway. Get captured quite easily.
Mm-hmm.
It's not. Not
it's
much
not
of
really
a
resisting either. No.
I remember the first time I saw this, I nearly shit myself when a guy jumped out of a tree with the little, with like the music, the sound effect. Yeah. Very disturbing.
I like the sound effect of the crossbow.
Yeah.
It's
yeah,
really
that's cool.
Nice.
Yeah.
Yeah, because Gonzalez's goons take Bond away to be killed, and Gonzalez dives into his pool but is shot with an arrow along the way. Bond uses the commotion to rid himself of his captors, meets Melina, who saves his life. And the well-dressed gentleman retrieves his money and walks away. And I love that he grabs the money yeah, that Gonzalez yeah, gave to the ladies.
Yeah, oh, that's so good.
That's about the sound they make.
Do you guys know why Melina was just standing there waiting for Bond? Why didn't she just
because
on
the script
running?
Said she would stand there? I don't know.
Yeah. Maybe she thought she was being chased. And
she heard something.
Yeah, and then she just
they were getting
decided
close
to, you know?
I have to turn around. That actually makes sense.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. Go, and the go first head on and just kill the
exactly,
guy. Yeah.
Exactly. And the first guy she sees, she knows immediately that he isn't the bad guy.
No, but look at him.
Because
he looks so lovely.
Yes.
Maybe she saw that Bond was captured by Gonzalez. So, yeah.
Could be.
Enemy
she
of
was
my
checking
enemy
out whatever was happening at the pool plants. It actually makes sense. There you go.
Of course.
Yeah, so
brilliant
someone
script
tries to break into Bond's car, which explodes.
Oh, yeah.
Got a great laugh in the cinemas.
What, why is that great? I don't get why everyone thinks it's so cool. I'm like, what has the car ever done wrong?
It's a great
they're break not out actually blowing up the car.
Yeah, I know, but
did
I'm
they
like, no, yeah. Well, it's
they hit it
because
behind
of
a tree
yeah
and they blew up.
And also, I can imagine when you are in the audience and you didn't see the trailer or something like that, you think, okay, you're going to get a car chase.
Yeah,
with all
the
gadgets, and then all of a sudden
yeah
the car explodes
yeah
and then you get a deja vu.
Apparently they did it because there were like a lot of like this sort of car theft racket going on in England, and also because they really wanted to show that with this movie, Bond's not going to rely on all his fancy gadgets and he's not going to go get the easy way out.
Is that another dummy moment with the explosion? The guy standing next to it?
I do love it's very cute though. Like the entire like 10 miles around the car just goes completely, just parts fly everywhere. It's not just like immobilizes the car, it just goes into a million pieces.
No, if that happens in a parking garage, the entire thing would blow up. Yeah. No half measures from Q. The Lotus blows up and Melina and Bond go to her car, which is a
I
yellow.
I love how Bond chucks his keys away though. That's just like one of those things
so
always makes me laugh, yeah.
No more use for this. And we get to the yellow deuce vol or 2CV. And it's also time for trivia round one. Are you guys ready?
I was born
not
there
a license plate, please.
No.
No.
Ah, thank God.
I promise we don't have a license plate. But I did steal Don's ID to do separate questions, easy and difficult, one for each. And we'll start with Martin. I have an easy or a difficult question for you.
Oh, let's go in easy.
Okay, a question about a Citroën 2CV. What was the last year Citroën produced a 2CV?
Oh, crap.
Oh, you don't have to know this.
No.
Martin has to.
Oh,
know
you horrible that man. No, I have no idea because I really don't care about Citroën at all. But it was they made it from like the 40s until the 90s. God, I've got no idea. I'm just going to go and say 94.
Nope. 1990.
Ooh, that's close though.
Yeah.
Give him half a point.
Yeah, give him half a point.
No, we don't do half points.
No, it's an easy question out of family.
Yeah.
So
that? Just out of contention, you can take a stab at the difficult question just because I really like this one. you won't get any points for it, but still. Again, a question about the Citroën 2CV.
Of course.
Greatest car ever made. Originally, the 2CV was designed to have only one headlight to save cost. After a test drive, Citroën decided to put on a second headlight.
Well
why
done, Citroën.
I've got no idea. Like I said, I really have I don't hate them. I have a small dislike for Citroën.
Maybe
like
for people the thought it was a bicycle?
Exactly. An oncoming car thought it was a motorcycle and crashed into it.
Well,
yeah.
Way to go, Don.
Yeah, there you go.
Okay, Don, one for you.
Easy
or difficult?
Yeah, easy. Definitely easy.
Okay. In the short story, For Your Eyes Only, the villain is killed on his estate. What is the estate called?
I don't know. I do know the villain. I don't know the estate.
It's at Mirror Lake. No, Echo Lake.
Yeah.
He's called von Hammerstein.
And Echo Lake is the correct answer.
Oh! That was a lucky...
Yeah.
Okay.
Want to have the difficult question as well, just for fun?
Just for fun.
In the short story, For Your Eyes Only, Mrs. Havelock enjoys watching two couples of Dr. Hummingbirds in her garden.
Oh, they have names, right?
She even has names for them. What are they called?
No, I don't remember that. It's like the opening of the story. It's something typical Fleming, that he starts describing a scorpion or whatever. In this case, he starts describing the birds. I can't remember their names.
Pyramus and Thisbe and Daphnis and Chloe. The more you know. Anthony.
Yes.
So that's 0-0.
Let's start.
No, I had it correct.
Oh, sure. Echo Lake. Sorry. Echo Lake.
Start with an easy one, please.
We'll start with an easy one.
Yeah.
Who plays Hector Gonzalez?
An easy one.
That actually is an easy question, but I have no idea.
The Cuban guy. What's his name?
You can really tell we prepared this right down to the details, can you?
No.
Okay, his name was Stephen Kalipa.
Where was he from? You know that?
Yeah, he's Indian and something else. I read it.
He looks very evil.
Did you knew this? Or did you look it up yourself as well?
I know everything, of course. I also knew the trivia about
it. Give me a tough question.
A tough question. The Great 2CV Chase was choreographed by a famous father and son stunt team. Yep. What's the father's name?
Rémy Julien.
I would have known that one.
Yeah, should have gone for the difficult one. Okay.
I don't get a point.
No, you don't get a point.
Come on, no. Not even
time.
You're tough on us.
Yeah, they'll get easier along the way.
Okay.
So we get that great car chase.
You first have the Melina.
I just have to do that.
Exactly.
In the country.
Let's start with Melina, who tells Bond that Gonzalez killed her parents.
Oh.
Bond says he's sorry, and then we get a very, very strange reaction from Melina, almost like, "Yeah, well, what the hell are you going to do about it?"
She looks at him like,
"Yeah, they're dead. Okay. Well, their rotting corpses are in my back seat, but that's about it."
That's what I mean. I don't like her performance every now and then. She looks a bit...
Stuff like that is a bit wooden.
Yeah, a bit weird.
But you have to fall asleep.
Backwards, forwards, quickly.
No, I think this is one of the best action scenes of all Bond films. As a matter of fact, I think For Your Eyes Only probably is the Bond film with the best action sequences in it. This one and some along the way, but this is fantastic.
Still, this is a great scene.
So entertaining.
Yeah. But Melina's acting or Carol Bouquet's acting, not up there.
No, but I don't bother it really.
She's outclassed by Roger, though. I mean, Roger is just fantastic in this whole bit, everything.
This is the famous animated gif, right?
When he's nodding to the other.
I love that.
That's so Roger Moore. It cracks me up every single time.
Have you ever done it in your car when you drive
with friends?
Someone?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, all the time. All the time. We're always like, when we go somewhere with friends and multiple cars just overtake and just look and then just nod and then just drive off.
You just said the quote, "I love a drive in the country," don't you? After that, I think Melina or Carol is actually laughing.
She's actually laughing, that's
genuine.
It's probably ad lib by Roger.
Yeah,
nice.
Probably.
It's also her best acting moment of the entire movie.
Are those walnuts?
No, they're olives. Olives?
They're massive then. Massive olives.
Yeah, Kalamata olives.
And this was shot in Corfu as well, wasn't it?
Yeah.
They basically stayed there for most of them. Okay.
Yeah, anything else? Because I agree with Anthony. I think this is one of the best Bond chases there is. And Also because my parents had several 2CVs during my childhood. So it's really is my Bond car.
You ever took the low road?
I think you really see that you know, John Glenn took over as director because he was, of course, prior to this second unit director, mainly responsible for action scenes.
Mm. What he does so good, I think, is filming the action sequences from the perspective of the character. So you have like a first-person viewing experience. Yeah. And he also does the same trick like he did in Majesties when he was editing and he put the guy upside down on the ice cream.
Yeah.
He does that in this film as well. It's very nice. Yeah. Nice little nod.
And what surprises me when rewatching this movie and taking notes is how long each action sequence takes. Because they're filled with actions and most of them are just at the edge of your seat action scenes, but they take 5, 7, 9, 12 minutes, each of them. And
then instead of 30 seconds.
Instead of 30 seconds, boom, bang, explosion,
and
we're
in this
gone.
Case, it's quite logical. I mean, a 2CV back in there had like 18 horsepower and the Peugeot calling them like 40, so...
It took them half an hour to get started.
I was going to say, it's just like getting the cars, like they went downhill for a reason, so...
I think 60 in 55 minutes.
What they did quite well, I think, is that the scene takes quite a few minutes because there are also some moments of suspense or that it, you know, slows down a bit. For instance, when the car goes upside down
with the bus,
and the bus.
I love that. But the bus has to back up and they're not moving and then the guy shoots and they're like, okay, we're backing up.
But that's basically not the car chase, but it feels like the car chase because it's part of the scene. And they do the same with the ski chase later on with the whole...
A lot of intercuts and different stories within the chase. I like it that Roger Moore's very good at speaking foreign languages. It comes off very naturally. When he's, it's only one or two words, but Pierce Brosnan really struggles with it.
No,
when he's
mine.
Does this mein Auto? I don't know. Don't even bother, guy. But Roger Moore really speaks fluently Italian or French or whatever.
And then there's the score, of course, which just makes everything so much better.
Just put it on while you're driving your car, and you immediately go, you know.
It's so great. So groovy, disco. Like, I remember driving home from I don't know where with a friend of mine in the car, like this came on because just on like a shuffle in one of my playlists, and like halfway through he's like, are you telling me this is and like a serious licensed Bond soundtrack? I'm like, yeah, it is. Like, I want to see this one. I want to know what kind of pills have been
used. Really surprised, because I really thought that this soundtrack would get or this score would get an immense beating by you guys.
From us?
Normally, if you ask people what is your favorite non-Barry, non-Arnold soundtrack, people tend to always go with George Martin with Live and Let Die.
This one also goes pretty high.
Or?
Hamlish, Spy Love Me.
I don't really like that one, except for Bond 77.
Yeah, me neither.
It's about the only part that I don't really like. But.
Well, we'll save that for another time. But yeah, I really found new appreciation for the soundtrack. Just keep on listening to it over and over again.
All right. Then we end up in a motel.
Hotel. Bella Vista.
Holiday Inn.
Was it a trivia question? No. Because I remembered that one. Especially because
Hotel Bella Vista.
Yeah, I know.
The Chinese have a saying, and Greek women, like Electra, always avenge their loved ones. Just a bit of character building between Bond and Molina. Not much else.
Now, did you think about Electra from Marvel Comics?
No, just Electra King, but I I always seem to think about Electra King when I'm alone. So.
I have the same with Aki.
But did you look up the story, the Greek mythology story of Electra? Her father was murdered and the king was murdered and then she had to revenge.
She came back to revenge her mother and her stepfather, right?
Yes, I'm right.
Okay. So we're back in London, back at the office of the Minister of Defense.
Oh, yeah.
Where Bond gets a tongue lashing by the Minister and the Chief of Staff. But luckily, Bond thinks of a way to breathe new life into the meeting or into the mission by going after the man who paid Gonzalez.
Why don't you try the identigraph? Well, get cracking, 007.
But I really love the portrayal of Roger Moore. It's I saw this film like already 20 times, or I don't know, and still it still makes me laugh when I see him look, you know, put in his face.
He's just like, well, I'm glad I'm getting out of here, you people.
Okay, so you watched it 20 times. Martin, your story about this movie, this might be a great segue into that.
Yeah, well, it's the very first movie I actually owned on any kind of, like capture device. And it was a VHS, so I've probably watched it like 237 times. And it's just...
about. Just you watch it, you rewind it, you watch it.
It takes one minute and 37 seconds to rewind it.
Actually, that's kind of something I talking about, like your experience with the movie, which is also something I got from my grandfather's, like a briefcase, and I only found out years later that's actually like the same Samsonite briefcase that Gonzalez uses to pay the guy. It's heavily battered because he used it for work for like 30 years, but that was pretty cool. So I have like locks and briefcase.
Was there any money in it?
No, just an old newspaper.
All right, and now we get our usual Q scene.
Smithers.
Smithers with the arm. Stinging in the rain. A couple of other gags as well.
The spy reference.
Yeah, exactly. Nobody does it better on the keypad. And we get the identograph scene. Some more quips ensue about a banana.
I love the scene.
Not a banana here. Yeah,
terrific.
And in the end, we get a perfect picture of Emil Leopold Locke, an enforcer in the Brussels underworld.
I love the printer.
Yeah.
We had that one at home when I was a kid.
And it's even a color printer. That was high tech at the time.
Whoever taught Q how to type? Because he did a very poor job.
I don't know if you saw this, but they synchronized their coffee drinking, Q and Bond. They take, they grab their cup at the same time. They take a sip at the same time. It's really funny. When you notice this, you can't see it.
But like a married couple.
Yeah, I think so.
The only thing that always bugs me a little bit with this scene is that like we go in there, everyone's working and like stuff going on, shit happening. And then like the lights dim. And apparently it should be like a cut to a couple of hours. But it's not evident that any time has passed. It's just like for you as the audience, like a door opened 3 minutes later and everyone's gone. I've heard
people that didn't understand that were confused by it. They thought, well, they only were in the room for 5 seconds. But then other people said, no, it's very obvious. It was all dark and they had their jackets off and everything. Yeah. It depends on how you read it. But maybe they could have edited it differently, that it was more obvious.
Yeah, something like that. Or even like, one of them very cliche things, like having a clock in the background, something like that, to help it along. Yeah. It's a minor grasp.
Yeah, well, Sharon comes in with a nice cup of tea.
Cup of mud.
I like that. Did you notice what the machine says at the end of the report?
Yeah.
I've read that. Yeah, I can't remember. It's so that nice. Was funny.
I wish my computer would still say that to me.
What was it?
This machine thanks you for your attention. Yeah. Goodbye.
Yeah.
That's really
nice. Really
polite computer.
A very Canadian computer.
And I hate Tanner here again. When Bond is telling that they found the guy, and Tanner's like, don't muck it up again. Bond, you bastard.
Also, I mean, hey, come on. He just saves the world from total Armageddon twice in a row.
Yeah.
In Moon, it's very grumpy, and now Tanner.
Maybe he lost a game of golf or something.
Give him a bit
more
respect, come on.
Awful guy.
So, the Italian Secret Service thinks that Locke is in Cortina. So, off we go. Hurrah, some more snow. Bond has a new Lotus, arrives in Cortina, where he meets his contact, Luigi Ferrara.
That was just like, that opening shot was like probably my fantasy. Like if I think about people like telling about a ski trip, like going on a skiing holiday, that is what I picture. Yeah. That is picturesque town and driving up there with a sports car with your skis on the back and just... It's also peaceful and quiet and
now,
nice.
Now what colour is this Lotus, Martin?
It's copper bronze.
I think it's very,
80s.
Nuanced. It's not orange, it's not brown.
It's a bit brown, bronzish, depending on the light. And they did that because of the snow, obviously.
Yeah.
And like fun fact, you can forget this immediately. Like I'm one of the people who thinks that Bond in an Aston in every single movie is a bit weird. I love my Aston Martins, but Anyway, Lotus actually referenced this themselves. They did like some kind of promo shot with an Evora in the exact same color scheme with the gold wheels and the stripes and the skis and everything, like, or snowboards, I think it was. It's in some kind of Lotus promotion clip. Like, you can probably find it on YouTube or somewhere. Mm. It's like a nice little what if, you know, if you had like four eyes only now.
Huh? It's one of my favorite cars.
It's just a shame it's a little screen time and no buttons to press or stuff. Oh, well.
Yeah. Oh, well. So we meet Luigi Ferrara.
Aww.
And Ferrara tells Bond that he will introduce him to Aris Christatos. And according to Ferrara, Christatos is in shipping, insurance, oil exploration, and knows everything that's going on. So, as a Bond fan, we know right away he's the villain. Right?
Yeah, yeah. I like the way the meeting between Bond and Ferrara is set up. It's a bit of spycraft, I think.
Yeah,
when he goes into his hotel room.
Yeah.
And it was written on his mirror.
Yeah, so Ferrara was there, right?
Probably, and he wrote that with a greasy finger or something. Yeah, and then if you turn on the hot water, it's boiling instantly in Cortina, obviously. Very steamy hot taps they have there. And it says where they should meet. And then Ferrara is like the most obvious spy ever.
Yeah. He's also one of my most likable allies, though. He's such a warm character. Yeah.
Luigi, I'll see you back at the hotel. Do you have these glasses a bit larger?
Well, it's Italian. They can get away with it.
That's true. So we meet Christatis, who gets all teary-eyed when he thinks about his protege winning the gold medal in the Olympics.
It's pretty strange scene. I like it, but it's, you know, it's the Bond villain, and he starts crying because of this little girl who might win the gold medal someday.
Yeah.
Okay.
Silly old guy.
Yeah.
You get the classic Roger, we'd like some information. It's there.
It is. Yeah. And yes, we also meet Bibi Dahl, a teenage figure skater, and her coach, Jacoba Brink.
Pull, extend your arms. and Locke is watching. Yeah, it's kind of, it's a strange scene, it is. Yeah.
I like the Locke inclusion, though.
Yeah, it makes it a bit
creepy. I like Locke as a character because he's really sinister and always in the background.
Yeah, and he never says anything. Right?
No.
Like, he's more like the coolest man I've ever seen drinking blue wine. So.
No.
Does it in a really cool way.
But I don't really consider Bibi to be a Bond girl.
She's the first Bond
just a bit of fun. She's just she's played for laughs, and that's okay.
Obviously. She has fun.
I like the scenes where she's
And in. I even think that she's quite a strong character, especially in the end of the film, when she actually stands up to both Kriegler and Christatos.
Yeah. Being smacked around. But
she's still a little girl or a young woman, but she actually tries. You know? She's not afraid. It's
I like her character, but I don't think she's a Bond girl.
No.
You like her character.
Yeah,
okay. Nice little anecdote. I was discussing our Man Talk episode with my girlfriend, and as you might remember, one of our questions was, if you were cast as James Bond, what three movies would you have liked to have starred in? And she immediately said For Your Eyes Only, and I was quite surprised because it's far from her favorite James Bond movie. So I asked why.
She can smack BB around.
Exactly. Her subtle answer was, so I could punch BB in the face.
Really?
Yeah, really.
She absolutely hates
her. But in the end of the movie, Christatos redeems himself by punching BB. sort of.
Come on. It's BB doll. Not a punching doll.
Yeah, BB is a fun character. Well acted, I think, better than Carole de Bouquet. Yeah, for Melina.
Yeah, but the acting is fine. Just such a shame that she had to act like a very spoiled, annoying little girl.
Yeah.
It's never explicitly mentioned how old she is. She's obviously deemed to be too young.
Too young.
Yeah, I think they're probably going. So. Yeah, something like 16.
Yeah. How old do you think she actually was?
She was older. I know she was older than 16.
Like, wasn't she only like half a year or a year younger than Carole Bouquet?
Yeah, she wasn't that young.
She was 22.
Yeah.
And Melina, played by Carole Bouquet, was?
23.
That's it.
So, what's the problem, Roger?
Yeah, I don't know.
I was going to say, like,
she looks a lot younger.
And Roger was, what was he? 50?
Roger Moore was 53.
Oh, 53.
What about Julian Glover, who plays Christatos?
He was younger, actually, wasn't he?
Don't do this!
Don't do this!
You had a very anxious Tyler.
Wait a second.
All right. Now I can't read your...
No x-ray.
Okay, I'll shut up.
Oh, stuff like this is what you get when you watch a movie 300 times. So.
Yeah, we get Cristados, who tells Bond and Ferrara that Locke is Milos Colombo's right-hand man. Colombo is a smuggler who fought with Cristados in the Greek resistance. And Cristados shows that he's an asshole by not shaking Luigi's hands.
Yeah.
Like,
hey. Okay, definitely Bond villain. Yeah. Now we know for sure.
And okay, I love the look, like the exchange between Bond and like, oh, well.
Yeah, I do too. And Luigi's like, what if I don't know? Yeah. Oh, well.
Do you also
because
know
he shakes his hand when they meet each other, when they say hello and not when they say goodbye. So I really don't get it, but we know immediately that Cristados is a bad guy.
Yeah.
In the center of Cortina, Bond sees Melina buying a crossbow.
Because that's what you do when you're in the center of Cortina?
Sure. And she's attacked by goons on motorcycles, but as always, Bond saves the day. Melina tells Bond that she's in Cortina because she received a telegram from Bond telling her to come.
Yeah.
Meet him there.
Who sent the telegram?
Yeah, exactly. Bond assures her that he didn't send her the telegram, and we never find out who sent it and why.
So who hired Gonzalez?
Cristatos in the end, because he's the boss from Locke, and Locke paid Gonzalez.
So probably Cristatos wants the Havelocks dead.
Okay.
So maybe that's why he invited her to come to Cortina.
But he could have killed her anywhere.
Yeah.
But he decided to
send her a telegram with a bomb in it.
Yeah. No, he decided to ask her to come to Cortina so he could have his henchmen on motorcycles try to run her over.
It's a bit strange, though.
Oh, well, you know, once you bought those motorcycles, better put them to use.
But it's never mentioned again, Melina's role is
but
in
she's
this
not
movie.
Safe, apparently.
Apparently, no.
Yeah. Can I tell you something about the flower girl in the shop, or can't I tell you?
It's probably a trivia question.
Yeah, you can. Yeah, it's good that you check.
Yeah, I'm just checking.
You're going to check from now on, Don, everything you want.
I'm going to check and recheck. But I found it funny that she was played by a woman who won a Playboy magazine contest to be in a Bond film. She just entered the contest, and she, for some reason, was the winner, and she got to play this part. And she also got a photography shoot, I believe, with Playboy as well.
She's probably be let down,
clothed
she?
From head to toe.
Yeah.
Yes, she is. And you see her for 1 second, I think.
Yeah,
but still.
It's a funny little quip. I like it.
Yeah.
So, Bond puts Melina on a train.
Amore.
Exactly.
It's a romantic scene. I really like the instrumental version from Free Your Eyes Only.
Yeah, but he kind of manhandles her when she wants to get up and he just slams her back into her chair.
They're the 80s.
Yeah.
Okay. You could do those things.
Okay. So
poor driver, though. He's going mad. You get wrong.
Vai avanti.
Trust me.
But exactly. Morse Italian is pretty good.
Yeah.
So, back to the hotel. Teenage BB is waiting for, and I had to look this word up, quincentenarian James Bond, which is 50-ish James Bond.
Am I the only one who really likes this scene? Please tell me that I'm
it's
not the only one.
It's cringeworthy.
Is it cringeworthy?
Yeah.
Why?
I think more places.
Yeah,
well.
Yeah, it's so funny. Could not have done it better. I mean, I think Bond does it excellently.
It's brilliant.
Yeah, it is, but I just don't like it. It's no, it just played for laughs. There's no.
But if you just assume that BB Doll is like a sex maniac that has it in for James Bond.
We're 16 years old.
Yeah. Then Bond does everything right.
He does. Like it does. His behavior is to be applauded, but and still, I don't know. It just doesn't do anything to me.
It's a strange scene in a movie like this. It's a strange character in a movie like this.
It takes the pace out of it a bit.
It's a pretty serious movie, pretty hard-edged movie, and you have the Blofeld scene in the beginning with the bald cap and the chimney, and you have BB Doll, and you have Margaret Thatcher in the end. And
But doesn't each Bond film has those moments? It's like, for me, it's like, no, this is better than the Tarzan yell, I think. This is better than the slide whistle or...
Well, the slide whistle is just awful.
Yeah, I agree.
That's the most awful
because
decision
the humor
in all
here
film
is in the acting.
the acting primarily by Roger Moore.
Within the film, it makes sense, yeah. Even though when you look at it, you're kind of hoping, oh, no, don't go there. But yeah, she's consistent within her role. Yeah.
But you say that James Bond does the right thing and he acts appropriately with her. But he assured Christados that he would accompany Bibi to the biathlon. Mm-hmm. And he leaves her as soon as he can.
Yeah, well, he has an appointment. Okay,
I have an appointment.
Yeah.
Yes.
He's bored with her. I can imagine that.
She can take care of herself, obviously.
Yeah.
Mm, and she can ski really well.
Yeah.
They visit the biathlon, where we see Eric Kriegler. And again, well, he leaves her as soon as he can. And it's time for trivia round 2. And I'm going to do this pretty quickly before Don can say anything that spoils all my questions. Let's go. Martin, would you like...
An easy one again.
Okay, you get the difficult one because the easy one has already been answered.
What was the easy one?
Yeah, just
who does Melina Havelock in the French version of the movie? The difficult one. Bond is wearing a blue jacket by a brand owned by a crew member. What is the crew member's name?
What was it again? It's what's it with the B thingy? Mm-hmm.
Go on.
Come on. I know this one. Like, because everyone thought it was because of the crew member. Like, it was a personal thing, but it's actually his own brand. But for the life of me, can't remember his name.
No.
As soon as someone yells it, I know who it is. But
Bogner.
Yeah, Willy Bogner.
Oh,
of course. Yeah.
Famous skier.
Mm-hmm.
Olympic skier, right?
I don't like these trivia so much anymore.
I'm sorry. Don, would you like an easy
one? Yes, easy.
No. Give Don an extremely difficult one.
I want
please.
An easy. Well, I get the choice. I want the choice.
What, you think we forgive you for your previous podcast?
Well, it's just a bit of fun, is it right?
Hard. Exactly, yeah.
I'm sure it's fun thinking it up.
Okay, the easy one. Bibi has a great strategy for winning the gold medal. What will be her secret to winning?
You know that one.
Yeah, I know that one.
I'm drawing a complete blank here.
Breath control.
Yeah, breath control. Right.
Yeah, breath control. Yeah. The difficult one was, in what year did Cortina d'Ampezzo host the Olympic Games?
1956.
Hello, exactly. He's asking me.
Wow. Sorry. Okay,
are you sure you don't have your questions mixed up? Like all the other questions I know except my own.
Oh, yeah. Well, both of you don't have any points, so now is my chance.
Yeah, here we go. No, Don has one.
We're from the previous round.
Yeah, that doesn't count. Okay. Now give me an easy one.
An easy one.
Yeah.
Willy Bogner's camera work featured in 4 different James Bond movies. Can you name them all?
Majesties, Spiral of Me, For Your Eyes Only, and I guess... A View to a Kill.
Yes, good. Correct. Done. The difficult question would have been, what make are Bond's ski goggles?
Ski what?
Ski goggles.
I'm glad I chose the easy one.
Was it Bogner again?
No, it's Carrera. And it's really subtle on the nose and on the... No, the goggles. The
goggles. Oh, yeah.
All right. So that was round 2. Do we want to do round 3 just in case there are questions that might... let's do round 3 straight away. Martin.
Oh, a hard one. Why not?
A hard one. All right. Both Christatos, Julian Glover, and Colombo, Chaim Topol, are said to be World War II veterans. However, they would seem a bit too young for that. Both are born in the same year. What year is that?
It was like 38, I think.
35.
35.
Oh. Unfortunately.
Oh, close enough.
Don't.
Easy, please.
Easy. Christatos, Colombo, and Melina are all said to be at least half Greek. However, in real life, all three have different nationalities. What are they?
Melina's French, or Carol Bouquet is French, mm-hmm. Topo's Israeli, mm-hmm. and the other one was Christatos, Julian Glover, British, I assume.
Ding, ding, ding. Yeah.
There you go.
The difficult question was, what number wore Eric Kriegler in the biathlon?
Oh, I have that down here somewhere.
I knew there had to be a number question in here. Not a license plate, but...
48.
Yeah. Anthony.
Difficult one.
Difficult.
Yeah.
During the film, Bond quotes a famous Chinese proverb. When setting out for revenge, you first dig 2 graves. What famous Chinese philosopher coined this proverb?
Sun Tzu.
No.
Was it Confucius?
It was.
Damn.
Yeah.
Oh, you know, what was my easy question?
Your easy question was, how old was Roger Moore when this movie came out? And your easy question was, what is the ship of the Havelocks called?
Triana.
Yeah. So we have, let's see.
I have 2 points.
2-1.
Well, 0, despite knowing your questions.
But we get...
I'll get my revenge.
We'll get a quote round.
Two graves then.
Okay, so that was round two.
I'm going to ski
and
now.
Round three, and we go. Yes, yes. We go.
Back to the
okay.
film. There you go.
Put on the score again.
Okay, this scene takes more than 10 minutes. Yeah. We get skiing, we get motorcycles, we get bobsled, we get shooting, we get ski jumping, we get action,
everything,
suspense. Guys, the floor is yours.
It's brilliant.
I was gonna say the acting, the action, the music, the setting, the speed of the scene, the jokes, the like Bond being inventive with the ski. I just love every single minute of this.
The guy returning after the Spy Love Me and Moonraker is drunk. The only thing I don't like is that Kriegler immediately looks a bit like an idiot because he falls two or three times.
He seems very incompetent for someone who was so well at shooting and skiing just a few moments before that.
Yeah, but skiing on Nordic skis is really difficult.
Did you just mention Viktor Turyansky?
Yeah,
that's
cameo.
That's a second trilogy that this film is part of. The Viktor Turyansky trilogy. This is his final appearance, right? With the wine or whatever.
The blue one. Yeah.
He was a location scout or something like that, right?
Yeah, and he's only in there for a fraction of a second.
Four frames, five, just blink and you miss it.
Yeah, I love that.
It's good,
It has so many sections, this chase. It's like 9 minutes or something. You have the hunting of Bond.
Yeah, the suspense.
And you follow the gun. That's a lovely shot again from the first person's perspective. Yeah. And Krieger is just toying with Bond. He's really enjoying it. And Bond looks awful in this scene, I think, with his with woolen hat. He looks so silly. Very incompetent. He's just with the stick trying to get to his gun. It's just, I don't know, a bit awkward.
Yeah, and his goggles squeeze his face together, which doesn't look very well very good. And
he makes up for it with the awesome ski jump right after.
Yeah,
I think.
Yeah.
And people look at him very strange because he's in the elevator with alpine skis instead of ski jump skis.
That's what I assumed, that he has the wrong skis.
Yeah. Exactly.
Very short.
You can see it from the shorts.
Yeah. Even the guy on top of the jumbo goes like, what are you doing? What
really like that? He's actually saying, look over there. That's the best microaft ever. What about the henchman? Are you guys have you watched Game of Thrones?
Yeah, Charles Dance. Yeah, he's a terrific actor.
The eyes. Yeah. What do you think if he would come back as Blofeld?
I don't know. He should come back as a Bond villain.
Now.
Yeah, because
like he is now.
You saw Game of Thrones?
Yeah.
Yeah, he's so good in it.
Yeah, he's horrible.
Yeah.
When he says something, you immediately believe.
He's really an arrogant guy.
Very, very well cast.
Cool.
Yeah. He goes up in the lift. Oh, do the henchmen actually have a plan? Because they split up. And then Bond has to go all the way up, and then he tells the Charles Dance character, "You go to the side of the slope."
They had a plan, but they.
But Krieger was thinking, as soon as he comes out, I will shoot him. But
so Charles Dance shouldn't.
Exactly, because he's confused whenever he's when he sees two people coming up the slope, so he doesn't understand who he needs to shoot. So it's like they needed cell phones or something to coordinate what they were planning. He does have a car phone, though. I like that. Locke has a car phone.
Yeah.
Probably doesn't work. But
and we have a silly sound effect again.
Oh, those are great. The music is
fast.
And it's also the first stuntman that died during the filming of a Bond movie, during the bobsleigh scene.
Yeah. Whenever you look at that, you wonder, how did they do that without Sirius getting injured? But apparently it went horribly wrong.
Yeah, and they tied someone. The guy on skis is tied.
I think that was Willy Bogner.
Yeah,
but he's tied behind the bobsleigh.
Yeah.
For some shots.
Yeah. Which is, that's crazy.
It is crazy. It is. And whenever he's in there, I'm always thinking, how do you get out? I mean, those things are going so fast. Mm. And then when he jumps out, it makes him look so easy. Mm-hmm. It's like, what? How do you do that?
And it's just ice. Amazing, amazing, amazing scene.
Amazing stunt
work. That takes more than 10 minutes, like I said. But it's...
Didn't a stunt man also die during the pre-title sequence of Quantum? When they were having
No. The guy died, but not during the shooting of Quantum of Solace. But
was it preparation or
rehearsals? Or a little bit later or something like that?
I think you should never make it so difficult or so...
dangerous.
Dangerous.
And it was like, wasn't it like Quantum was like one of the guys went off the cliff and like bringing one of the cars to one of the sets? I think it was something like that.
Mm.
Like rain and storm. And
this is one of the reasons, one of the strengths, I think, from For Your Eyes Only, the action.
Yeah.
It's mind-boggling. Yeah. It's so fast.
And like you said with the car chase, it's not all jump cuts and fast editing. It just feels very fast, very flowing. Yeah. Very.
The ending, though, we get some more silly sound effects. We get the and the chickens. He goes through the barn. It just that cracks me
it
up.
It is a Roger Moore film, after all.
And then Krieger, you know,
he picks up his bike.
Why? What the hell are you doing?
In his defense, he has a strange way of picking up heavy objects and trying to throw them. It will be his demise at the end of the film.
It doesn't work out very well for him.
Stop picking up blunt objects, idiot.
So we had this incredible action sequence.
Yeah.
10 minutes. And then we go to Bond, who says goodbye to Bibi at the ice rink and gets attacked by hockey players. Right after the amazing action sequence we just had, we get this totally unnecessary.
Yeah, this is the worst scene of the film, I think.
That's strange, because...
I like it. I don't know. It's a guilty pleasure, I think.
No, I just wanted to say, I always skip those few minutes after he says goodbye to Bibi, then we just continue to Corfu.
Yeah,
but let's skip the hockey players. But you like it, Martin.
Yeah, it's I don't know. It's very Roger Moore-ish, but
it is.
it always gives me a laugh. I don't know why.
But you know, a few hours earlier, you tried prior to this, you tried to kill Bond by world class champion, and two motorcycle guys, and I don't know what.
So who are these three guys?
And then it doesn't work out. So what you decide? Mm-hmm. Three idiots on skates trying to kill him.
And they know that he's there.
Yeah,
for some reason, and he falls down and he's unconscious. Obviously.
Yeah.
How does it work with ice hockey, with the scoring mechanism? Is that automatic? As soon as you hit the goal, you get a sound? Or is a fourth man actually keeping score up there?
Yeah, that's probably
with the computer.
Yeah.
I mean, how does that work? I don't know. Yeah.
that's probably lock after killing...
Very easily knocked out.
Yeah.
Let's go to Corfu.
No, but wait, I have a very important question. What is the difference between farewell and goodbye? Because I'm not a native English speaker, neither of us is, but
I think
Bibi says farewell, Mr. Bond, but not goodbye.
Farewell means we'll see each other again.
Does it though?
Yeah.
Because I always thought farewell was very permanent.
Yeah, it is.
It has a very permanent ring to it, as Stromberg.
She's 16 years old, so she probably mixed up those words. It happens.
She's 16 years old, horny as hell, so can't blame the girl for
it. You wanted to say something about...
Yeah, I was just saying you were going to go to Corfu, but you skipped one of the most disturbing things of the entire film.
Oh,
Poor
Ferrara,
Holding a pin of a white dove. We are led to believe that he was murdered by Locke on behalf of Milos Colombo.
Mm.
Now we go off to Corfu.
Ah.
Bond meets Melina in Greece. Some sightseeing, not much happens. I love it. Just a little scene.
This is what I like. Yeah.
Just nothing happens. We just see a bit of the
country and the locals.
The local.
A bit of dancing. A bit of fruit eating. Doesn't taste that great.
I like it as well.
And then this beautiful instrumental rendition as well.
Yeah.
And we get some more character development between Bond and Melina when they're looking out over the bay.
It's an interesting choice there because it's an intimate scene. But John Glenn decided to, not use close-ups or anything like that. Don't show their faces, but just from the background, see them with this beautiful scenery.
And they probably added in all the dialogue in the studio.
Of course, but it's interesting that they chose for this.
I think it works, though. It's more it like establishes the relationship between the two. You know, Bond really... No, isn't interested in her like a lot of other films. He would have been in bed with two or three women by now. But in this one, it's all a bit different.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Are you guys ready to play some baccarat?
Always.
Why, sure.
Okay. We meet Countess Lieschel von Schlaf. And we know Bond has a thing for countesses, so we know how this is going to end. Bond and Christatus...
You can count on that, right?
Exactly. Bond and Christatus have dinner... A bit of snobbery about wine.
But what about the casino scene?
Yeah, Bond wins at baccarat.
Don't you like Bunky?
I like Bunky.
He's a strange character with a droopy eye. It's just he has no reason to be in the film.
He doesn't do anything.
It doesn't do anything.
No. But it's only introduces.
He's there to lose to Bond.
Yeah. But this is something that maybe I got it wrong. But the first game they play, Bunky has an 8. And Bond turns over a 5, and the croupier says, "Neuf."
It looks a lot... I thought the same thing when I saw it. Because
I didn't think it was a 9.
No, his second card is half...
I think it was just a bad edit. Because he also has the diamond 5 of diamonds in the next game. And I just think that during the edit process, they used the same shot.
Well, they like forgot the...
No, but you play baccarat with several decks of cards in a shoe, right?
Oh, it could be. But anyway, I didn't think he actually had 9 the first time.
I thought the same thing when I saw it. Yeah.
And then we get Cassandra Harris, or Liesel.
Yeah.
Well, we all know who she was, right?
I haven't got a clue.
No?
No, she was Brosnan's wife. This is where the producers saw Pierce Brosnan for the first time and thought, we should keep an eye on him. Who knows?
But I like Bunky's face when he loses. No one says anything. Sad. Yeah, it's just, but he is so sad. Yeah. And the Countess is gone. Yeah. It's like, where did she go?
And the funny thing is, baccarat is more or less, it is a game of chance and more or less 50-50. And Bond always seems to win. He always wins.
Must be frustrating.
He either stacks the deck in his favor or he's the luckiest man alive.
Yeah. I really like this overall scene, though. Like I said, just like the Corfu scene, not much really happens, but just nice flow, some exposition, some deepening of the characters.
Yeah. I also like the next scene where Christatus and Bond are sitting at the table and ordering dinner.
Snobbery.
Some snobbery about wine. Yeah. Their table is bought by Colombo, which is straight from the novel the short story Risiko.
Yeah.
Really nice. And Colombo sends Liesel to seduce Bond to get some information.
Are we now at Liesel's place?
If you want, we can go.
I'm just checking. Okay, we'll stay at the casino for a moment.
Okay, so they're discussing that Bond needs to maybe kill Columbo.
You might even have to
kill him. Yeah, exactly.
Just tell me where he is.
Yeah, and that I love how they changed that in the film from the short story. In the short story, there's some elaborate scheme going on with the switching of chairs, and all of a sudden there's an extra chair at the table with a cushion, and the tape recorder is in the cushion, and then the chair all of a sudden has to be taken away again because another party is coming.
I said for tree.
Yeah, exactly. So here it's much simpler. It's just in the base of the candle, and it's taken away, and Columbo's in his office listening to it with his pistachio nuts. I like that. He's just listening to it.
Yeah. And I actually paid attention, I went on holiday in between these podcasts or before this one. And I actually paid attention to it, like when we went to the bar at night. And I actually paid attention to how little attention people pay to waiters and stuff. Yeah. Exchanging glasses, taking away the candles, to refresh the candles. It's actually very
invisible.
It's a very good one.
And then obviously Columbo knows that Christatus is betraying him, selling him out to the British. And is it the same here in the film as it is in the short story? Because in the short story, Bond is offering Christatus money to end the smuggling. That's his mission. Mm-hmm. He's allowed by M to spend money, lots of money, to Christatus to end the smuggling. And then Christatus goes along with it if Bond also assassinates Columbo. And then in the short story, Bond has a brainwave like, this man is really smart. Not only am I paying him, I'm even assassinating someone he wants to get rid of.
His rival. Yeah.
So that's quite smart. Yeah. It's slightly different here in the film. Yeah. It's very well done, I think. If you have to sum it up in like a few minutes, this is brilliant. When Columbo comes back, they make a scene, Lisa goes out, you get the same quote even. This might be a trap if you play the odds. It's from the same from the casino. I like that. Yeah. It's a smart way of changing it for a film.
Yeah, I like the rivalry between these two men.
Cristados and Columbo.
Yeah, old friends.
Yeah, that is nice. You can imagine that.
Yeah.
That they're also buggering each other.
So, are we going to Liesel's place?
Well, we're
going
to go to the car, right?
In the car, inside the car, you mean?
Toward Liesel's place.
But no, even before that, I was reading my notes, sorry. We see Melina at the casino, very briefly.
Oh, yeah.
Why? Yeah. What is she doing there?
No idea.
How is this relevant?
She probably got a telegram.
Yeah, but it builds up something that never is fulfilled.
True.
It's like, okay, she knows something that she's not supposed to know.
They should have cut it out.
Yeah.
Well, I had been thinking, you know, the mental podcast, you know, if you could change things about a film. I was like, I think it would have been better if Locke would have been there. That would have been cool.
Sitting in
the background.
The table.
Yeah.
He's lurking there.
Might be a bit too public.
Mm. But then again, he's always lurking in the background.
Yeah, but
just
on a crowded...
Like,
yeah, or outside, because he knows outside. That just,
but you think she's jealous if she sees Bond leave with Liesel? Or why? She's giving him a look like, what's going on here? But it's never really explained. Never comes back.
Maybe she thinks you're supposed to find the killers of my father and mother, not...
Well, he's working on it.
Dating with some countess.
It's a tough job, but somebody's got to do it.
I love the car scene, though, when Bond pretends to be a rider and he straight up asks her, well, a lady in your position would know many things. Do you know any smugglers?
No.
I would be very grateful. How grateful?
Very.
It gives this shape with its entire body. I love that very. It's it's perfect.
In the short story, he promises her a clip from Van Cleef & Arpels.
Yeah.
Diamond clip.
He does, yeah. Mm. And then this is perfect, I think. They arrive at the house. They get out of the car. And she says, what did she say? I have some champagne and oysters in the fridge. Would you come in for a bite?
Yeah.
And Bond Roger Moore with his... face, I love it. Yeah. He scratches his nose like, I won't be
naked. It's so, like, the man is just, like, he can be so understated about her just inviting him over for a night.
Great.
Even the chauffeur is laughing when he turns around.
Yeah. Like, ever
perfectly
the gentleman.
Played. Yeah.
Wonderful,
Roger Moore also seems the most dated Bond of all the Bond actors, I think, and especially in this movie, because his clothes dated really bad in my opinion. But he also he really seems like a man from a different century almost.
You mean what, too sophisticated or too
the way he looks, the way he talks, the way he dresses, the way he
treats people.
Yeah, it's
that's
just
all part of why I love Roger, I think.
Yeah,
Wonderful man. Like, if we could just go back to when people spoke like that and acted like that against one
but
another.
Nowadays, he would be a joke, right?
Yeah,
he
would be
probably.
Yeah.
But
I do think like Bond should ever be the gentleman and not just the brutal self killing machine that he's becoming now. But, oh well,
I think it's nice that we have different versions of Bond.
Yeah,
I agree.
There's something for everyone in this franchise.
And sometimes you feel like watching a gritty Bond, or sometimes you feel like watching a Bond
Time's
in space.
Forever. Yeah, well, I didn't write too much down about the scenes that follow. I mean, we learned that Liesel von Schlaff is actually Linda from from Liverpool.
What do you know about British accents? I don't know that much about it.
This isn't Liverpoolian.
It isn't?
No, I don't think so.
Because
I heard it somewhere because of
I heard a British podcaster was annoyed by this because topographies on a map, Liverpool and Manchester are very close, but their accents are very different apparently. So he was annoyed that Bond
got the accent wrong. Yeah. He would never make that mistake. It's like, okay.
Yeah,
we don't know
course,
that. Most people don't know that.
Yeah, it's probably the same that we got angry that he speaks German
in
Diamonds
Are Forever instead of Dutch.
Speak Dutch.
Yeah. It's the way it goes.
But like you, Tyler, I didn't write them down much. They have some more sex. And then it's morning.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, morning.
So, after a night of rumpy pumpy, 007 and Liesel take a stroll on the beach the next morning, where Liesel is killed by Loke.
That brutal scene.
That's a horrible stunt to perform.
Really, yeah, you really see her, you know, hit
she was actually the glass with her head. Yeah. Wasn't it like her stunt double was actually injured by it? Something went wrong with the angle or the way she was hit or something like that.
Yeah.
I read something about that.
Instantly believed that. Looks horrible. Yeah.
And there's a picture on the reverse side of one of the VHS tapes. I think it's The Spy Who Loved Me, where you see Bond and Liesel von Schlaf standing on the beach. So they used the picture from For Your Eyes Only for The Spy Who Loved Me VHS. And For Your Eyes Only was one of the last classic Bond movies that I ever saw during the 90s. So all of a sudden it hit me that's where that picture's from, because I never could find it in The Spy Who Loved Me or any of the other Bond movies, and all of a sudden there it was. I remember that vividly, but
so where is Liesel going before she's hit? She runs off for some reason.
Yeah, some people do
back
that.
Back to the house, I think? She runs
up
the hill.
She was close to the house already.
I mean, she runs towards the house, I thought.
Bond is screaming, Liesel, come back, Liesel!
She probably sacrifices herself for...
But I have to run because...
I'm scared.
So Bond wants to shoot Bond or kidnap Bond or whatever. But before he can do so, Bond is saved by Columbo's men. And, of course, they knock him over the head and Bond wakes up on Columbo's yacht, where we meet the man himself.
Yep.
Columbo tells Bond that he's been set off by Christatos to take the blame, and that Christatos is the real villain of this movie.
No!
Dun, dun, dun!
And, of course...
And finally Bond knows what we
exactly.
How does he know Bond, James Bond of the British Secret Service?
Everybody
knows Bond. He saw Moonraker probably. What do you think of Columbo?
This is the Karen Bay of this film. This is the Draco, the Tiger Tanaka. He's wonderful with his nuts and his voice.
Trying to think of a better way than being a stereotype, but like of the way I know the Greek people, it's very, very close, you know, very amicable, very friendly, very... open
a bit larger than life character. And
like, if you look at all the allies, like the way I look at allies, like if they're a good ally or not with Bond, like if the pairing is good, like would you, if you were Bond, like go out on the town with a man? And Columbo, I think that would have been one hell of a night.
I think, yeah, I can have quite a laugh with him.
Yeah.
Well, once when I was with Columbo in Tokyo.
How would your response be nowadays if you cast three, or if you write three characters of Greek descent and you cast British guy,
non-Greek,
French girl and an Israeli?
There's some backlash probably.
Yeah, but that's just
Twitter would explode.
You know, this scene always made me dizzy for some reason. Whenever I see it, whenever I watch it, I don't know why, but it unbalances me.
Because
and then I
camera.
Notice that they shake the camera slightly to make you feel like you're on a ship. They tilt it or something.
Yeah,
and
see,
it actually works. Yeah. It actually
works. Yeah. Makes you seasick.
Yeah. But it's funny how that helps.
That one before.
So what's your take on Columbo, Anthony?
Good question, because I've been thinking about it. Do I think he's a caricature too much a bit or not? And then I decided I really like the guy. Because I
like
every
said,
single sentence that he pronounces, he says it with such coolness. Your government might give him another medal. I really like the way he says it. The most easiest lines, he makes them sound really cool.
You know how he was cast, right?
Yeah, he was in Fiddler on the Roof.
Mm-hmm.
And Broccoli knew him, right?
Yeah, wasn't it Dana, I think?
Yeah, they met each other on some sort of banquet for a good cause.
Mm-hmm.
And Dana was like, Cubby, Topol, Cubby, how about Topol for Columbo? And that's how they did it.
Dana. I'm glad they did, though.
Yeah.
He does a great job, and he might be a bit over the top, but because in this
nice
movie,
nice warm character,
yeah, and it works in this movie.
Yeah,
I like it that he's sad for his poor Liesel,
but also the way he says it.
Yeah. Yeah.
You can remember every single line.
Yeah. Liesel doesn't die in the short story. She does no. here.
Hmm.
Yeah, it's quite sad. Yeah.
No, and he states that he has several Liesels on hand. So Bond or Columbo takes Bond to
Albania.
Yeah, Albania.
Off the coast of Albania.
We get the raid on the warehouse.
Yeah, ending in the death of Luke.
Once again, I think a strong action scene.
Yeah.
It doesn't feel nearly as long as it actually is.
No.
It's about five minutes.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it just like... Yeah. It's
you know what feels long? It's the running of the stairs at the end. We'll get to that.
The poor guy. We'll get to that. Well, if you want to discuss this action movie, because a lot happens, and I like the way how Columbo uses his pistachio nuts as
a
trap for the...
A bit of a Basil exposition with diving equipment.
The gym,
just some brief explanation.
Yeah.
You might see that later on.
I love some of the jokes and like Bond and Columbo jumping and almost like killing each other.
Almost hurting each other.
That one. Like,
I think it's well edited, well crafted. I like it that it's at dusk or.
Yeah, dawn.
Yeah, it's dawn, right? Then the
morning.
Yeah,
it's dawn. Yeah.
It's pretty much straight from the short story that they copied it. In the story, they also have this huge newspaper print rolls in the warehouse. That's kind of nice. And what I noticed, and that always leaves me with a few question marks on the beginning, is that there are these mines in the warehouse, these huge mines that are also in the beginning when the St. George's blows up. So that makes me think, was that an accident at the beginning, or was it a mine placed by
interesting.
I always Stratos. Thought it was placed.
I always thought it was an accident.
No, I always thought that because they bring the mine back on later on, I was like, they're laying out a connector dots for you as a viewer.
Yeah, it's a bit too ambiguous for my
They case. Don't really explain it later on when Bond and Melina are at the Triana and they're trying to figure out where the wreck was. It's Mike Cristados, oil exploration, diving bell. There were some things going on, but it's bit vague about how did the ship really sink, where did it sink, why didn't Cristados just go there before Bond, but I don't know. Does it really matter? I don't know.
I like the explosion. It's a great explosion.
With the wire and the...
Yeah, because you see Bond running and then the entire building explodes.
Locke is a full bastard.
Yeah.
I like when Locke is running with two machine guns. Almost like Pierce Brosnan.
Better than Brosnan.
Yeah. And then we get to the chase steps.
Yeah.
I think when they filmed it, it was one location, right?
Yeah, it was like one or two sets of stairs.
One street, but they made it seem like an entire town they were driving around. Is that true?
It is one street.
It's just one street that they used over and over again. Bond, Locke seems to be driving in circles all the time. He can't get away from Bond for some reason.
No, I thought it was just a mountain road with hairpins.
Ah, right.
Yeah.
But in real life.
Yeah, I thought so.
I do but think there weren't as many stairs as there are in the film. Like they made poor old Roger run up the same stairs five times.
And get back and take two. Here we go.
Well, I love this one. As I said on the other podcast, this is the very first stuff I saw of Bond. Like, the running up the stairs, the essence of the coolness of Bond, just standing there, spreading his legs, taking aim, and then just... I was like, this guy is the coolest guy I've ever seen. And I, like, 5 minutes after that, my dad's like, yeah, there's a bunch of those films. I was like, okay, I need to see them all right now.
Where are they?
Yeah.
This is the crucial scene, right? This is discussed many, many times.
Yeah, we got the famous scene where he sort of kicks the car over the cliff, but...
Yeah, it's more implied than it's actually...
Yeah, and he's also... The car already is slipping. So a lot has been made of this, that... Roger Moore didn't want to kick the car over the ring. And
he apparently said, like, the pin should have been enough to outbalance the car. But they said, you know, he killed your friend. So
yeah, exactly. But now it's a bit in between.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I agree.
Car is already going over the cliff, and he gives it a little kick.
To hell with you.
Do you think he should have made a remark about Liesel as well? He says something like, "This is for Ferrara," or "You left this with Ferrara."
I believe.
What about Liesel?
Yeah,
he probably
didn't
know her name anymore.
I'm trying to kill the case for.
I'm sorry.
I like it that the car doesn't explode.
Yeah, it's one of the few films it doesn't explode.
I also like that the body of Locke is
thrown out
of the car.
Yeah, yeah.
And she's lying on the rock.
Great action scene in this movie.
It's a good classic scene. Yeah. Yeah.
And Bond meets Melina underwater. However, they filmed this on land by having a big fan create a movement and then playing the footage back in slow motion and adding the bubbles in post-production. When you know it, you can't unsee it.
Yeah.
However, I think it looks great. It's one of these things that I still really like. Okay, yeah. I know how you did it, but it looks very good.
Yeah, I agree.
I was gonna say the first couple of times before I knew that, it didn't really bother me. Like, you could see that the blue was a bit more blue in the close-ups, but I thought that was just because it's a different camera. And then later I read it's because Melina couldn't breathe or whatever. She was afraid or something.
No, she had problems with her ears, I think, or her
something.
No, still looks good.
It was something medical at least. She couldn't go underwater.
Yeah.
So it was obviously a stunt double.
Yeah.
I have a couple of questions here that you might help me with. Why did Bond dive in the first place? Why didn't he just wait for her to come up? All he does is dives towards her. Hi, here I am. Now let's go up.
Be friendly.
He can just wait.
He probably came to surprise her.
He's impatient.
But
I
he
think.
Did that like half an hour ago in the film when he went to Corfu and he met her at the docks.
He likes,
but now
diving.
He wants to swim.
He's impatient.
I was going to say he was just like he just killed a guy and kicked someone off a rock and survived a building explosion. He's probably like just going for a swim.
All right,
he was probably hoping for a domino.
You would have done the same, Dom.
Okay, so why would you put your oxygen tank at the bottom of the sea for
because
no apparent
it's
reason?
Very convenient.
Yeah, that is a good question.
That is a good question. Do you have a good answer?
No, because it makes absolutely no sense.
Unless she has the gift of foresight.
Or perhaps, she just leaves oxygen tanks all over the...
I hope not.
All over the
sea. They filmed this in the Bahamas, right? The only place on Earth where you have beautiful blue water.
Oh,
I think this went especially to the Bahamas for this. These other wonder scenes. And I like it. It's a bit of weird contrast, but Bond, or his stunt double, obviously, Roger Moore's stunt double, is fully covered. He has a very extensive diving suit.
Yeah, like
suit.
The frogman.
And Melina's
suit,
nearly
yeah.
naked. just
that's how it should be.
Sorry. That's the way we like to see it. Yes. Yeah, so Bond and Melina go to retrieve the ATAC, but are being attacked by a guy in a gym diving suit. And I love it that before they head out, Bond says to Melina, "Speak only when necessary." But then reads her the entire manual.
You're already underwater now.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
With a great Bond theme rendition. Can I just...
Yeah.
What would you like to say about that?
Oh, there's a brief scene. Back on board, they don't know exactly where the St. George's sank, so it's a bit dubious where they have to go. And this is always, I found, a bit easy storytelling. They find the log, and you hear Max, daily log, which is... Well, I think this is smart, actually, because they already established that the parrot keeps repeating stuff.
Yeah.
And this comes back later, obviously. Mm-hmm. But then, only Melina can decipher her father's shorthand. That is a bit easy, I think.
Mm. It's quite convenient.
Yeah, it does really bother me.
No?
It's a brief scene, and it's over before you know it.
So do you understand what Bond is talking about? He says, a diving bell, oil exploration... Christatos. There we have to go.
Okay.
I don't really follow his
No, it's not
reasoning.
A really thorough research, and the conclusion is a bit
well,
based
there's
on nothing.
The ring. Let's go.
Yeah,
let's get into the Neptune. And here we get the third and final trilogy.
So we had the Rubovich trilogy. It's part of the Rubovich trilogy. It's part of the Viktor Turyansky trilogy. And it's the third and final entry into Let's Put Roger Moore into a Yellow Jumpsuit trilogy. Moonraker and The Spy Who Loved Me. Yeah,
just the way that Ian Fleming intended it.
Yeah, but it's amazing though. Yeah. So they're in the sub. Yeah.
Yeah, and I just love this Bond theme, the green notes. It's a cool scene for just a submarine doing what a submarine does, and it just Bill Conti makes it sound very exotic and very spooky. And
I agree with you, Tyler, that Roger says, you know, be spared with your oxygen.
Yeah.
Don't speak only if necessary. Could you have said it on board of the Triana?
Yes.
Yeah, and also he reads her the entire manual of the ATAC.
Yeah.
And then I will clip the
There is somewhere on YouTube, or at least there was like a clip of someone actually resubtitling it, and it said like, "Oh no, help! I can't breathe!" Halfway through, it doesn't make any sense.
Do you have any trivia questions anymore?
No, just at the end, the quote Ron.
Because you know the age of the guy who's in the suit, right?
Yeah. No. I was just curious about when they're diving. I know nothing about diving. Have you ever?
I did it once.
You are a diver?
In the water. In the Greek. Greece, actually, yeah.
Wow. Well, they dive, and I had to look this up. Divers usually dive about 20 meters, 60 feet.
Mm-hmm.
And 40 meters is pretty deep already. What I found was that's like 120 feet, which is kind of like a maximum. And there's a record of 162 meters, which is about 530 feet.
Yeah, free diving.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They go beyond that.
Yeah, but...
But they're in a submarine.
Yeah, but then they go out as well.
Yeah, but they have a special suit.
Yeah, it's they need special equipment. They're very deep. It's like Bond always wants to break the records. They're nearly at 180 meters or almost 600 feet. And I was just wondering about this. I don't know that. But can you just wear a regular watch?
This one is...
Will it break? Or they don't have any gloves on? No. Isn't it cold and dark?
This one is rated to 1,000 feet, so 300 meters. So...
That's deep, man.
Yeah.
But you're a diver. Is it cold? Is it dark? Is it?
Yeah, but
you went once and all of a sudden you're a diver.
You dove once? Come on. Let's have all the facts.
I wouldn't go so far as I can compare myself to Bond, of course, but I went to about a depth of 10 meters. And it's cold. And it's creepy. I didn't like it.
Yeah, but I can imagine it. It's
because the only thing you hear is yourself breathing, and it gets claustrophobic quite easily.
Kind of like in this scene when the gym diver is...
That's what you hear, actually. Yeah.
It's like as if you're Darth Vader. Yeah.
So it's creepy.
Okay, well, thank you. Yeah.
This entire sequence does nothing to me. Compared to the rest of the movie and what's still ahead, this really feels like filler to me.
I agree. I'll go along.
Yeah, it's the weakest part, I think. Or is it one of the weakest parts?
There because
film?
We need the ATAC, and
basically, there are two parts, right? You have them retrieving the ATAC with the diver, and then when they're back in the sub you get another submarine. Yeah. What's it called? The Neptune versus the Mantis.
Thing, yeah.
I think they could have left that at the Mantis.
The second part, I agree.
Because the Mantis guy is still stuck there down somewhere.
He's still there, probably.
Yeah, he's still there.
I saw him, as a matter of fact, when I went down there.
He got out, didn't he? I thought he got out. I thought there was like a little shot that you see the...
That was very briefly.
Or an extended edition that you saw, but no.
No, and especially because Christatos is already waiting for them on the ship.
Yeah,
why bother? So he could have just waited for them there. I mean,
But they need to find the ATAC. I think that's pretty necessary for the
plot. So yeah, so the first part of the scene is necessary. I think it's pretty okay. The scene it's tense, especially when you know that the guy is
some pretty gruesome sights. The body's floating, and that's kind of very scary. They take the bomb. Oh, right, I timed this.
I'm of course. Lena can hold her breath for 7 minutes.
That they made that. The scene is only 6 minutes, I believe. So, yeah, they made that. They have oxygen for 8 minutes, but they're back within 7 minutes. But the bomb was supposed to be a minute. Uh-huh. And that's almost 2 minutes.
Oh, right.
But that's just poor editing.
Suspense.
That's the way it goes. Yeah, I love the explosion though. When the diver explodes.
Yeah, awesome. The water explosion. Yeah.
Very well done. Yeah.
That was all miniatures, wasn't it? I think the miniatures were at design 007. the Neptune and the. And the little guys. I thought they had those models at designing the model as well.
But I agree, it's not the best part of the film.
No. It doesn't do it for me. No. But then we get a great scene that comes straight from the novel Live and Let Die, where Christatos ties Bond and Melina to a rope and is going to drag them through shark-infested waters. I love saying that. Shark-infested waters. And like you do, you are a bad guy, so what do? You don't shoot them, you just tie them at the end of your boat and you drag them through water with coral and sharks.
How do you feel about Eric Kriegler's swimming trunks?
Actually, I didn't notice them. I was still in awe of Hector Gonzalez's swimming trunks. Well, of course, Bond is able to survive. So is Melina. Christatos makes the common mistake of assuming Bond is dead without seeing his floating corpse. And Max helps out our heroes by telling them that Christatos has taken the Ajax to St. Charles. Anything about the dragging through shark-infested water scene?
Besides, I think you already mentioned, I think it's a strong scene and it's... Of course, it's Fleming material, so it's great to see it finally.
But it's well shot. I believe they didn't want to film it for a long time because they also couldn't figure out the logistics. How do you actually film that? Mm-hmm. I think it's very well done, the way they managed to explain what was going on. He has to go back and forth through the reef. Christatos is very evil. I like that. And beautiful shots again.
Yeah,
the camera turning upside down. And the cuts, you can just feel it when it goes through
generally uncomfortable.
Coral,
What do you think, by the way, of Christatos as a villain?
He has his moments, but he's quite poor in general.
When they wanted to make the film, they wanted him to be more realistic. Mm-hmm. They didn't want him to be an obvious villain. Large, they didn't want him to have quirks or anything. And that works very well.
Yeah, but it's not really memorable.
He has a basic, simple plot. Quite believable, but he doesn't have anything very distinguishable.
No.
I was going to say, the moment you're trying to make a very basic, undistinguishable villain, you get a bit of a basic, undistinguishable movie. Well, that's the risk you're going to take. And some people might argue that this is.
No, I don't necessarily agree. I mean, Stromberg isn't the most memorable villain, but The Spy Who Loved Me is a great movie.
Yeah, but his whole plot is nuclear annihilation and not selling a modern day.
Okay. Yeah, and he has a great henchman as well. Yeah. So. Now, the thing that if I think of For Your Eyes Only, the thing that comes up to me is beige.
The Verons are a bit generic.
There's nothing wrong with beige. I don't hate it. I don't really like it. It's just there.
It's there, yeah.
Okay.
And
I can see where you're coming from. It's like one of those Sunday afternoon Bond films. You know, just nothing on to you, just put it on. Just,
I don't really
have to pay attention. It just...
I don't agree. I think it's a very, very strong action thriller because it just goes from one strong action scene to the other. And before you know it, 2 hours are over, and once again, I enjoyed the ride.
I know I'm in the minority here, and
I disagree with it being beige, but I can very clearly see where you're coming from. Let me just put it like that. Like, I really like the film, but I can see why other people wouldn't, as opposed to some others.
It's in between two movies that, dare I say it, I like more. I find more enjoyable.
Well, we'll get to the ranking.
We'll get to the rest.
I got a few more points about something that I like as a filmmaker. I really like the transition when they cut open Melina's jumpsuit and it goes into the squawking of the Max.
Because she
has a yellow jumpsuit and it makes the noise. And then you see the yellow parrot that also makes the noise. I like that. I think it's very well done. Nice editing. And what I always was thinking about is Christatos tells Kriegler to take it to St. Cyril's, but we find out there are more than 400 St. Cyril's. So how does Eric knows which one he should take it?
No, that's, he doesn't. And that's why Gogol is late on the appointment, because he's been to five St. Cyril's already.
He's been to 400 different
St.
Cyril's.
That makes sense. But I do like about Christatos, because he's a bit bland, we just talked about that, mm-hmm. or a bit generic. Or beige. I like it that when the guy falls overboard, he just says, oh, I'll leave him. The sharks won't get him. I like that one, yeah. And then also, he assumes that Bond and Melina are eaten by the sharks. Idiot. Always check. Yeah. Always double check.
Yeah. Bond meets with Q in St. Cyril's. Another one of those lines that should have been for M.
Probably something like a Moonraker-esque scene, I guess. You know, with like M and Moneypenny, everyone in a castle, I guess.
Yeah, maybe.
But I can't really see Bernard Lee wearing a fake beard. Fake beard and robe, yeah.
Now, this scene doesn't make any sense to me.
No, it's totally unnecessary.
Why would Q fly all the way out there to say two lines?
I don't know. And then Bond, I know.
But I know someone who does know. So why don't you go to Colombo in the first place?
Yeah, it doesn't make sense.
There are at least 439 St. Cyril's in Greece.
Yeah.
That's what Q is being sent out to tell.
But we do get the classic line, though. Forgive me, Father, for I have sinned.
Yeah.
That's putting it mildly, WSM.
And we see Michael G. Wilson in the background as a priest.
Yeah, he's the priest.
You see him standing in the doorway.
Yeah.
So it is necessary, in a way.
So we get this silly scene. Let's go on with the important parts. Because Bond calls Columbo for help. And together with some of his men and one woman, they plan an attack on a monastery built on a cliff. Christatos has set up shop there with Eric Kriegler, Bibi, and her coach, Jacob Abrink. And we get a fantastic climbing sequence with a terrifying fall off the cliff. Rick Sylvester does it again. Mm-hmm. Probably the two most famous stunts in the Bond franchise, or at least two of them. And again, we have a scene that takes almost 6 minutes, but it's so tense it flies by. Yeah,
true.
I love this climax.
It's the entire climax.
But I think this is almost like the inverted volcano from You Only Live Twice, where it's bigger and bigger and bigger. You get whole armies fighting against each other. And here it's very tiny, very low key.
Also, the coloring, it's all very, not beige, but grayish, brown, earthy colors.
It's quiet instead of loud.
I also love the attention to the, I don't know if you guys noticed, but I noticed this time, like, I paid attention, and Roger isn't actually wearing his shoelaces anymore from the part he uses them to go up the stairs. Like, if you see a shot of his shoes, you actually see he doesn't have any shoes. You know, it's just stuff like that. Yeah. It's just attention. Like, Bond films get some credit for, you know, stuff reappearing and disappearing. But
But this scene proves that, you know, a climax of a Bond film doesn't necessarily need to be explosions and huge armies fighting each other.
When he fell down the last time, I actually felt it in my stomach.
Yeah.
It's like, oh my God, he's falling.
I saw this film in the cinema 2 years ago.
After the death of Roger Moore.
Yeah. The memorial of Roger Moore. And then I had the same with this scene. Yeah. Seeing it on the big screen, he's falling down. Yeah.
And I love what Rick Sylvester said about this, that it goes against everything you know and you've learned as a climber to let go and let yourself drop.
And the thing he said about his, because there's like some kind of safety cushion or something, and he was like, he didn't like the scene because it looked like from way up there, it looked a bit like a coffin, and I can actually see the cemetery, so, you know, it doesn't take a genius to connect the dots there.
Another thing I would never do.
Not in a million years.
Nope.
And after all this, Columbo and his men, and again, one woman, storm the monastery. Along the way, they get some help from Jacobo Brink, and in the meantime, General Gogol is on his way to pick up the ATAC. I love how Columbo knocks out the guy that Melina shot. Just a nice
Yeah, true.
I'll follow you.
Sorry. Christatos redeems himself by slapping Bibi around.
Now, I think Bibi is very brave here.
Yeah,
I mean, she's really trying to stand up to the guy.
Yeah, but she's annoying as
hell. You can go now.
What is it? Is it the sound of her voice?
I want to win the gold medal.
That's
what she wants to do. Especially if she's a teenager. Yeah, she's quite short-sighted.
She loves ice skating, so of course she doesn't want to go to Cuba.
I know what they're trying to do, but she just comes off as whiny instead of pissed off.
And of course, I do not condone the slapping of women, but we're in the 80s and we're making a podcast about a movie. Just a disclaimer, of course, I do not condone.
You were afraid for some reaction.
I just want to make it clear. I mean, I would definitely ask my girlfriend to do that.
I gave a presentation last week on James Bond to about 60 or 70 people, and I called them the ultimate male fantasy. And then after the presentation, a woman came up to me and she said, "I don't agree with you. It's only a small percentage of men that really like James Bond. As a matter of fact, I think he is dated and he shouldn't be. He isn't
a character.
Not relevant, but also it's he is not a topical character anymore. He shouldn't be part of modern day cinema."
There's a great Clint Eastwood quote I'd like to insert right there.
Yeah, no, I invited her for our next podcast. So
okay, that's going to be very interesting.
No, we had quite a rough discussion because I didn't agree with her, of course.
Well, like I said, the famous Clint Eastwood quote comes in handy. Opinions are like assholes. Everyone has one.
Yeah.
Can we go briefly back? I'd like to talk about the scene where they disarm the guards.
Sure.
Now imagine that, because they follow Jacoba Brink through the courtyard to the guards section.
Yeah, Mene Bond. Yeah.
Yeah. Imagine that you are a guard. Would you scream out? As soon as they come in, would you just yell like intruders or something?
No,
I mean, these are very inept guards.
I would pretend if I was sleeping.
I don't know. I guess
everything they have going for them is the element of surprise. So as soon as you shout out and they know that they're there, you can.
Yeah, but that starts when Bond is hanging there by a thread on the cliff. If the guy just looks over his shoulder, and screams out, "Hey guys, there's someone here!" But probably they don't really have their heart into it.
No, they are really not that enthusiastic about doing their job.
I thought there was a bit taken aback by everything.
They're probably underpaid.
Why are they there in the first place?
Like semi-socialists. So.
Yeah,
I like it when they go into the guards room that Roger also checks the other doors, making sure no one's coming in there. It's like a nice little nod, But yeah, bad guards. I would scream, hopefully, if I was a guard for Christatos.
Would you like to be part of the Christatos gang or the Columbo?
Well, they don't have color-coded suits.
Exactly. No coveralls.
Fatal mistake.
No coveralls. Yeah. We get a fight between Krieger and Bond. We knew this was going to happen.
He has to pick up something heavy.
It's not memorable.
It's a bit silly.
Like we've had Grant, which was better. And then, you had the big tall guy in Magazines as well. And then we have Stamper later, which are all better than Krieger.
So in my opinion...
But it's not just Krieger. It's also Roger Moore's stunt double.
Christatos sneaking out with the ATAC.
That is very slippery. I do like that one, actually. I do like him just like slipping away. No. That's like the redeemable fact of the whole point of having a villain that's down to earth.
Krieger is not memorable, so his scene is also...
And we get the most incapable dummy falling from the cliff.
Apart from Tomorrow Never Dies.
looks like a ragdoll.
Probably is a ragdoll.
Melina is about to kill Christatos. But Bond stops her only to see Christatos being killed by Columbo.
Prior to that, I liked the little fight between Columbo and Christatos on the stairs.
Just tackling each other.
I was going to say, the tackling each other, but then he just clings onto his foot. And it always reminds me like when you're a little kid and then you're clinging onto your dad's feet.
Yeah, but these are two old friends, and then they finally...
It could have been a bit more aggressive for my taste.
What is it you like so much about
it? That Christatos is really trying to escape and Columbo is doing everything he can to stop him. So he literally hangs on his feet.
But Christatos knows he can't escape, right? All he wants to do is get the ATAC to
Gogol.
Yeah,
but maybe he can ask Gogol, "Can I fly along with you?"
Yeah.
I was going to say, Gogol has the guard with a gun. So.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, Bond gets the ATAC first.
Yeah, meets with Gogol and throws the ATAC off the cliff. World saved. How do you like this ending?
It's a bit silly because Gogol knows Bond. I mean, he called him Commander Bond in The Spy Who Loved Me.
Mm-hmm.
So does he really assume when Gogo is walking towards him, he sticks his arms out like, give me the ATAC? Does he really think that James Bond is going to give him
He's got a guard next to him.
Yeah,
with a gun. Gogo really wants to have the ATAC.
Here we go. It's like he's assuming that James Bond will just hand it over to him.
Yeah.
Well, he does make sure that the guard doesn't shoot Bond.
I like that. As soon as Bond throws it at him. Yeah, that's strong.
I think it's a good ending.
Yeah, but the goodness of it is more down to Gogol than to the rest, I feel.
And it's more like Bond says, you don't have it, I don't have it, but the entire idea at the start of the movie was just to destroy the ATAC. So Bond actually...
fulfills his mission, you mean?
Yeah.
So that's good.
It bothers you.
It bothers me a bit because I like Gogol, but all of a sudden he seems unable to speak English like he did in previous films. He doesn't recognize Bond.
He does recognize Bond.
I'm not sure he does. What makes you say
There's
that?
There's no continuity in these movies.
No, exactly.
No worries.
And then he's like, okay, fair enough. You don't have it. I don't have it. Detente. Yeah. I have to explain that to some people nowadays, what that means, but that's okay. And then, okay, I'll just sit and go back to the helicopter and fly back for 3 days in a row.
But I think he reacts in this way because he knows Bond.
I like his reaction. Like, all right. Well, that was a trip.
I hope he has a good book to read on his flight home. I mean.
And he didn't know, of course, that he would meet Bond on St. Cyril. Right, so he's probably surprised. Hey, there you have James Bond. I know him from a couple of years ago.
He's gonna give me the ATAC.
Yeah.
No, he
isn't. And Bond thinks, hey, there you have General Gogol.
He looks burst for rare.
I'm not gonna kill you, but I'm not gonna give you the ATAC either.
Okay.
Enough.
What about the fact that Melina doesn't get to shoot Christatos?
I think that's good.
Yeah.
I don't.
You don't want her to have her vengeance.
No, but it's also a good ending of the rivalry.
Yeah. I was going to say, it would have made it less likable.
If she had a fight or Christatos was about to shoot Bond or something and she would shoot him with her crossbow and save Bond in a
Thunderbolt way would have been better.
Yeah, then I would have liked it, but not in cold blood. I don't like it when people kill other people in cold blood.
So you like it that Bond intervenes?
Yeah, I do.
And then Columbo.
And it also... It really fits Roger Moore's character in this movie, being a bit father-like. I have the experience. I know I wouldn't do it if I were you. So yeah, I do like it.
Okay. And then BB ending up with Columbo as a new sponsor?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, he thought I'd forget.
Well... he has some pistachio nuts to take care of.
okay.
All right. And
back to the triangle.
After this terrible pun, we get probably the weirdest scene in the entire Bond franchise. Max the Parrot tries his pickup lines on Margaret Thatcher.
Before that, I like that they're kissing, and then Bond and Melina, and then she's asking, you know what I'd like? And Bond is all, I can't imagine. He's already searching for his condoms or something. And she's like, Moonlight Swim. And he's completely disappointed. that face, it's wonderful.
You can still do a Moonlight Domino. So. Yeah.
But I agree with you, Tyler. You know, the Thatcher scene doesn't make sense at all.
I was going to say, like, bringing current-day politics in it is probably the single most stupid thing you can do.
Yeah, a bit like Saturday night.
I don't mind it. I like it.
I like the husband more, who tries to get some of the
slept on
the head. I like that, yeah. And Freddie Gray is loving it. Do you see the Minister of Defense? He's like, oh, we got through. Yeah. This is great stuff.
Yeah.
After all this time, they still don't know they... shouldn't patch Bond through directly to
anyone.
To the White House.
You should have known better by now.
Yeah.
But I like that we got another reference to the title by Melina, For Your Eyes Only, Darling.
Yeah.
Roll
I like credits. That. And then we get the credits and we get the end song.
Now, before we continue with our rankings, we have to finish our trivia questions. And we've got a real barn burner on our hands. 10 points if you know that reference. Are you guys ready for the quotes round?
Ready before you were born.
All right. We'll start with an easy one, just to get things going. So for 1 point, finish the quote. Martin. Oh, by the way, we haven't been properly introduced, Melina. My name is Bond.
James Bond.
There you go. Yeah. You got a point.
I won.
All right.
I got a point.
I wouldn't know that one. Quite difficult.
Dom. This one's for you. Yes. Well, you get your clothes on and...
I'll buy you an ice cream.
Ding, 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 ding. All right. Anthony, this one's for you. Meanwhile, if there's anything I can do for you... Again. Meanwhile, if there's anything I can do for you...
Anything at all?
No.
No. Sorry, don't... No.
Give us a kiss. Give us a kiss.
Oh. Did you guys do this?
Oh, I thought this one was pretty easy. I'm sorry.
No.
I
never quote the parrots, so that's probably... you should have asked a Columbo quote.
Okay. here we go. Round two. Martin. Well, I know too much about him.
God. No, forfeit.
He wants me out of the way. Don, seriously, you may have a job finding one.
I have no idea.
Well, you look like a gentleman. It's before Liesl and Bond get into the car.
Ah.
About a taxi
driver.
Right.
Yeah.
Tough. Anthony, a Colombo one. Let us drink to that.
I'm not sure.
Let us drink to that.
Yeah, but I'm thinking, is now Bond there responding or is Columbo saying something after this?
Bond is responding.
Okay, then he says, I'll rather wait till dawn or something like that.
I'll wait till tomorrow.
I'll wait till tomorrow.
Sorry. Round three. Martin.
Final round?
Yep. I'll have the prawns, salad, and the bordetto.
Bond says that to Christatos and then something along the line. I don't know, something along the lines of like, excellent, I'll take that too or something like that.
An excellent choice. I will have the same.
Wow.
I need to have it.
Yeah. Oh, you are strict. You need it verbatim.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah. Don, how did you know where Gonzalez was?
Through a detective agency.
Yeah.
I knew that one.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
Yeah. Anthony.
Can I stop now? I'm pooped.
another half hour of practice, BB.
Yep. That's for Miss Brink to decide. I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
And then she says another half hour practice, right?
Probably.
Yes, she says.
Probably. Yeah. Okay. I think Don won.
Oh, I can pick a card for the next film. Where the card?
But before we do that, it's time to rate the movies.
Oh, I can't. I'm going to pick
will.
The card.
Yeah, in a moment.
Okay.
But first, we're going to rate this movie.
Okay.
Where does it fall on your scale from 1 to 10? 1 being the lowest, 10 being the highest. Martin.
I've been thinking about it, and it probably clouds my judgment that it's the first one I saw over and over and over and over and over again. But it's a solid 8. I really enjoy it, as far as people probably haven't heard us saying it, but the score is excellent. I love it. There's some great action pieces in it, and yeah, I can watch it any day of the week.
Your appreciation for the score, all of you, is what amazes me the most of this podcast, really. And I really like it. Anthony, what's your verdict?
For Your Eyes Only is my favorite Roger Moore Bond film. Yes. Sorry, guys.
I was gonna say, you earned an eyebrow raise for that one.
Yeah, it's a close call with Spy, but I just really enjoy this film, and I can't put my finger on it exactly what the reason is. I like the action. I like the score. I like, 2 hours fly by. I like the fact that it's a bit more gritty, but still... has some really fun scenes. I'm going to go for a 9.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Wow. Done.
Yeah, I was struggling with this one because I think I started off wrongly when we started this podcast because I was the only one who didn't have a list. And I started off with giving some films some certain marks and now it didn't make any sense anymore because, like you, Anthony, this is my favorite Roger one. But I already scored Live and Let Die with a 9. And so I was struggling. So what I did was I came up with a tier system and I put groups of films into different tiers. And I'd like to retcon a few of my grades. And then it makes sense now to me, at least. For me, it makes sense. So what I did was I looked at the scores that I gave for Live and Let Die. I gave it a 9, but I want to change that to an 8. And that makes the average 7.8. But we can change that on the website.
Yeah, right? We'll change that on our website.
I'd like to change as well, because I have another insight. I'd like to change Diamonds Are Forever it's not my least favorite Bond film anymore.
Whoa, really?
I'd like to change the 1 to a 3.
Wow. Ooh. That's quite a
I'll give it a jump. Point for the score, which yeah. I think is absolutely amazing, and I will give it another point for the Tom Mankiewicz one-liners.
Oh, that very good.
Okay.
I have a new least favorite Bond film, but we'll get to that.
Yeah.
I'd like to also change my The World Is Not Enough score from an 8 to a 7. I slightly downgraded it a bit. And now I can come to my For Your Eyes Only score, which is a 9, my favorite Roger Moore.
Nice.
There are 2 scenes I'd cut. The ice skate scene with the attack on Bond at the practice ring. And I'd cut the Mantis submarine scene.
Totally agree with you.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
And then yours truly.
Yes. Well, I'm going against the grain here. I like this movie.
Well, that's something.
Yeah. I think it's engaging in parts, but a bit dull as well. When I think of, I've already said this, when I think of For Your Eyes Only, the color beige comes to mind. So it's not bad, but it's not very exciting either. I score it a 7, which I think is still pretty good.
Yeah,
but
it is.
Yeah, compared to you guys, it's a bit lower, but anyway.
So we get an average of?
We get 2 9s, an 8 and a 7, and an average of 8.3.
That's
very good. That's the second highest for now.
It's up there.
Yeah, it's pretty good.
And shuffling the cards.
So that was For Your Eyes Only. James Bond will return, and so will we, but not before we pick our next movie. Since Don won our trivia round, he can randomly...
First time I get to pick the card.
You can randomly pick a next movie. Go ahead.
Okay, here we go. It is next month. We're going to talk about...
Guess I'll die another day.
Oh, crap.
Sigmund Freud.
Oh, yeah. Bring it on.
We're going to talk about Die Another Day.
Okay.
I think I'm calling it sick.
Oh, okay.
All right.
From Casino to Dr. No to For Your Eyes Only to Die Another Day. That is one hell of a change. Okay. Looking forward already.
Yeah, me too.
And with that, we come to an end of our 6th movie review. Follow us on social media. Simply search for the 00 Files. Subscribe to our podcast in your favorite podcast app. And contact us at moneypenny@the00files.com or visit the00files.com for in-depth articles, location videos, and more 00 fun. See you next time.